QIQT. And in this session, basically, what will all of you learn how to compute the wave function for different states of the molecules and atoms, and then how to propagate the superposition state in time, that is basically the wave packet. And wave packet is basically the central theme in the quantum information. And therefore, so this wave packet, I will see that there are many speakers are going to talk about the propagation of the wave packet in time, which is the central theme in the quantum information. And it will be very, very beneficial all the participants. So with this background, I request our director, Professor Saurabha, to introduce the first speaker and chair the first session.
Thank you, Ashwini. Once again, it's a very pleasant task to be back to this QIQT workshop. I was there in the day one for my talk, and then I had a pleasant duty to chair one more session before. And today, it is the day of quantum chemistry, I believe, in the QIQT workshop. And as you all know, these we have been discussing the entangled states and how they kind of expand the quantum, the computation from the classical exponential time scale to a polynomial time scale. And I think the quantum chemists have used the quantum mechanics to a great effect. And I think they will also be a very big users of the quantum computers whenever they're available with sufficient number of qubits and so on. So today I'm very happy to welcome all the speakers actually at the session. But my very special welcome to Professor Satyamurthy, who is the inaugural speaker. And in particular, because we are very well connected with each other, and it's a great pleasure really to introduce him, because I know him. I'm trying to think since when I actually know him, but it must be around 1981, 82 at least, if not earlier, when I was a PhD student at the Indian Association for the Cultivation of Science. You know, I had just about graduating and then about to join National Chemical Laboratory in Pune. That was the time I still used to come to Kolkata very often. So I met him because he was also in a conference in Kolkata. And I think since then I know him. So it's really very long time now, almost 40 years that I know him very well. He was, of course, a young faculty at IIT Kanpur that time. And I was also an IIT Kanpur student, but somehow he came just after I graduated. So I did my five-year integrated master's in 1977, and I believe he joined around 78, 79 at IIT Kanpur. So I think that was so close that he could have been my teacher in a very formal way. Of course, I respect him as my teacher anyway. So and my guru in many other senses in the quantum chemistry community, because you always, when you grow up, you always need somebody to look after. So Professor Satyamurthy has been one of them. I have to say that he has a very busy life, very busy career, and I'm very thankful to him for accepting our invitation to deliver this talk. I also thank, before I formally introduce Professor Satyamurthy in few words, I also thank Professor Panigrahi once again for arranging this mammoth workshop, I must say. And today, of course, Ashwini is looking after it, but his team has really done. It's a one-month workshop. It's not very easy. So I remember it started in the middle of June when I had to give the inaugural address. And it's still continuing. And very, very good speakers he has been able to bring in, as we'll see in future programs as well. Just to tell a little bit about Professor Satyamurthy, of course, many of you know him. But I think it's a pleasant task to formally introduce him in as few sentences as possible. He has been, as I said, a great inspirational leader of theoretical chemistry in India for a very long time. I think that is very important first I want to mention. And speaking about his own education, he did his BSc and MSc at the Annamalai University. And then PhD, I believe, with RAF, I think in Oklahoma University. And then, of course, he went for postdoc in John Polanyi's group, in John Polanyi's laboratory. As many of you know, John Polanyi has been a Nobel laureate. And after that, he joined in 1978, as I said, at IIT Kanpur as a lecturer at that time, and then eventually became professor in 1985. He contributed, as I said, in the field of theoretical chemistry, particularly in molecular reaction dynamics and computational chemistry, and atom-molecule collision, transition spectrum, and several things, and very lately on host-guest interactions. What I want to say is that apart from his science and the teaching that he has imparted, he has been a great administrator, because after, in the middle of his tenure at IIT Kanpur, he actually went to Indian Institute of Science Education and Research, Mohali, and became the founder director of that institute. So just as, of course, I don't have to tell you about ICER, because we are one of those. ICER Mohali, I just want to tell for record, came 1 year after ICER Kolkata. It was established in 2007, and Professor Satyamurthy was given the task to lead the first ICER Mohali's first, to bring the first director. And of course, as you know, being the first director is never easy. And he had to do a lot of constructions. And I think all of us know the constructions are hazardous task. And I think he continued to do that for 10 years, a little bit more than 10 years, actually, just about 10 years. I think 2017, when he really kind of stepped down from the ICER Mohali directorship. And by that time, he had just about retired from IIT Kanpur, but he continues to be associated with IIT Kanpur, and then eventually got associated with ICER Mohali, and he's also associated with us at ICER Kolkata, I must say, as an honorary professor. So we're very happy that he kind of brings in certain value systems to all the ICERs through his teaching, through his mentoring people. And to say a few more things, obviously a person like him would get a lot of recognition. In fact, it's very hard to read all the awards and recognition that he has got. But I should say, in the very early days, he got INSA Young Scientist Medal. This I remember very well, because I met him around that time, actually, or just after. And then he had also got Indian Chemical Society Ernapolli Memorial Award. I mean, it's very important to sometimes go back to the very early awards, because you can keep getting awards, but you always remember the first set of awards. At least I always feel that you are somehow connected to the first awards, and that INSA Young Scientist Medal for many people have been the first major professional awards. So I want to mention this. And of course, he went on to get very big awards like Santi Siru Bhatnagar Prize, of course, the most prestigious prize in India in chemical science in 1990. He became, of course, fellow of the Indian Academy of Science for Bangalore in 1990, fellow of the Indian National Science Academy in 1992. He got Sir C.V. Raman Award, Horiam Trust Award, and then, very importantly, he got FICCI Award. You know, it's an industrial award, but he got FICCI Award in 2001, Silver Medal of CRSI, Chemical Research Society of India, one of the most, I would say, influential chemical societies in India today, in 2001. And then he became fellow of the international the World Academy. Today it is called the World Academy of Sciences. That time it used to be called Third World Academy of Sciences in 2005. He's also the Jesse Bose National Fellow of the Department of Science and Technology. And that in 2006, and I must mention, that was the year, if I again recall, Jesse Bose National Fellowship was first started. And of course, as I said, one of the major contributions that he has eventually, of course, people will remember, is that he was the founding director of ICER Mohali. And for quite a long time, he has steered the ICER Mohali. He has set a kind of a goal for ICER Mohali, which is very important. It's one of the major institutions of science learning today in this country. So I think, as you can see, that he has done a huge amount of research and administration, and taught in several places like IIT Kanpur, ICER Mohali, of course, these two places he has taught, and obviously has been associated with many other institutions of the two. One thing I must say before I conclude, that his leadership has also been seen in the chemical community in the country. He was, of course, the president of the Chemical Research Society of India which, as I said, is one of the leading. There are two chemical societies, but Chemical Research Society of India has been playing a very influential role of late. And he has been the president of the CRSI from 2017 to 2020. So you can see that also shows the recognition and the leadership that the community has kind of agreed kind of to give him. You know, that is very, very important. To get a recognition from a community is very important. And I think I must say that was one of the great things that today, when you look up to the leaders, I mean, his name automatically comes up as one of the very, very few people that I can think of in theoretical chemistry. So I think with these few words, they're supposed to be very few, but they became slightly longer. But excuse me for that, Professor Satyamurthy. I will not take your time further, and I will request Professor Satyamurthy to deliver his talk.
Thank you, Sarov. Thank you. I'm embarrassed with the long introduction because, except for the fact that you started your graduate studies at the time I just started my job as a lecturer, our careers have run parallel to each other. And I must tell the young people, since you mentioned about ICERS, Professor Sarov Paul was in National Chemical Laboratory, Pune, and along with Dr. Sivaram, oversaw the entire curriculum development for ICERS before ICERS were born. This was a stage where ICERS were conceived, but still not known. You know, the pregnancy test was not confirmed, so to say, because when we started writing down the curriculum, the philosophy of ICERS, what we should do, what we should not do, etc., the next day, one of our colleagues, the former founder director of ICERS Kolkata, went and made a presentation to the Planning Commission, which approved ICERS, the two ICERS, ICERS Pune and ICERS Kolkata. And Mohali was the third born. And of course, now there are seven siblings in total. I'm delighted to be here. I want to thank Professor Panigrahi and Ashwini Tiwari for asking me to give the first talk today in the general area of quantum chemistry vis-a-vis QIQT. I would like to mention before we get started, I must congratulate Professor Panigrahi for doing the second school on QIQT, quantum information, quantum theory. The reason I said that is that it means it's time for you to bring out a monograph. I remember I did two winter schools on reaction dynamics, and DST wanted me to bring out a book. So I brought out a book, edited book, Recent Advances in Reaction Dynamics. So you would, since the QIQT is in its state of infancy, Professor Panigrahi and his team would do yeoman service to the community in formally bringing out a book, introduce and then take it further. At the risk of taking some of my time in saying something more, I would like to mention that chemistry and computers have had a very interesting relationship. I will show you some examples how chemistry was handicapped when there were no computers. And the initial calculations were done, you know, my generation would say, let us crank it out. I never understood. When I went to America, I saw for the first time a calculator. I had not seen a calculator before. Earlier, I would do things by hand, you know, multiply, divide, all that stuff. In college, we learned log tables. And since we were not engineering students, we did not have a slide rule, but I learned slide rule. Now, you may think, why is this guy talking all these things? Has he not come prepared for the talk? I have come fully prepared for the talk. As you will see from my slides, you see how calculations are important for development in quantum chemistry. Where does quantum mechanics end? Where does quantum physics start? Where does quantum chemistry end? Where does quantum biology start? Very difficult to to say. But this much we know, quantum mechanics was discovered or developed. And today it has its imprint all over, including biology. I have not seen its impact on sociology yet. But people do use the language in common conversation that was a quantum jump. You know, so the people are aware of what a quantum means, well, whether they know it or not, but they use it as a language. So in the beginning, when Saurav Paul, when he mentioned about chemical dynamics, in the very beginning, quantum dynamics was handicapped because they did not have a calculator. So they had these machine cranks, that's why it's called a crank. And then later on, the electronic computers came. And this was done in few places, particularly in the University of Illinois. They had a computer center. The last issue of Resonance carries an article on Ruton. It tells you how Ruton was using the Illinois computer under the guidance of Professor R.S. Mulliken. Mulliken, of course, got a Nobel Prize. And Ruton is a common name in quantum chemistry. It's a Ruton's equations are there. Ruton's formalism is there. And now I understand that he is advising and he has played a very important role in development of these high-end chips for Hewlett-Packard. In other words, he acts as an advisor. So 57, 58... two landmark calculations were done. One was actually the first calculation was the quantum wave packet dynamics that Dr. Tiwari alluded to, referred to. It's interesting how even before the computers became a big deal, they were trying to solve the time-dependent Schrodinger equation numerically for an atom and a diatom coming together, a hydrogen atom coming together with a hydrogen molecule, forming a new hydrogen molecule. Almost simultaneously, the classical trajectories were developed. Because we are used to thinking in terms of classical mechanics with objects as particles. So Wahl-Hiller and Porter did the classic paper on, Wahl-Hiller and Mazur did the classic paper on classical calculations. Mazur and Rubin did, Mazur is a common name between the two papers. Mazur and Rubin did the first quantum mechanical wave packet dynamics calculations. Then fast forward in the 60s, people did wave packet dynamics. Ashwini is going to talk about wave packet dynamics, at least from the abstract I saw, about one-dimensional wells and, you know, wave packets penetrating through barriers, going through the wells, etc., came up. Late 60s, early 70s, every time the computer technology would improve, when I say that, that means more memory was available. They were not called chips at that time, they were called circuits, or integrated circuit, ICs. And as they were developed, they become faster and faster. Now you know the Moore's law. Every 18 months, the computers get faster and the memory capability increases, you know, factor of two or whatever. And then the 60s, electronic structure calculations became fashionable, again in Chicago, University of Chicago, for understandable reasons, because Ruton was there, sort of knows about Chris Wahl and Das. Wahl and Das did some of the early MCSEF calculations from there. And then in the 70s, people started doing my Guruji's Guruji, that is RAF's supervisor Cooperman, was the first one to come up. George Schatz, who has been a chief editor of JFE Scam and Bauman. Schatz and Cooperman did the what is officially called the full three-dimensional close coupling quantum calculation. This was time independent. And this was 75. You know, Schatz submitted thesis in 75. Then 76, 77, the papers came. And then when, as time went in the 80s and 90s, people are still talking about three-dimensional quantum calculations for an atom diatomic molecule. So every student almost every student who came to my lab, I see today's one of the speakers is one of the organizers, Ashwini Tiwari. So he did some of the quantum wave packet calculations. And before him, Sushant Mahapatra, who is going to be a speaker later in the day, did calculations. Every stage, the computing technology progressed. Quantum chemistry, quantum dynamics progressed the next step. And required what level of sophistication was required in terms of memory and speed was kind of dictated. This, of course, was done simultaneously by the high energy physicists, particle physicists and all, but high energy physicists required more and more computers and other fields. Let me stay with chemistry. Quantum, what you normally call a quantum chemistry, that is electronic structure calculations and quantum dynamics vis-a-vis chemistry, have gone in parallel with the quantum technology, with the computer technology. It's quite befitting that the development of quantum computers is anticipated with great enthusiasm by physicists and chemists. Physicists probably have more to worry about quantum entanglements per se than the chemists. But you know, many of these statements look silly as years go by. Yesterday I saw George Shatz has advertised for a position to undertake a project of dealing with quantum entanglement with molecules, which means molecular excitation with a single photon era is behind. I would not say over, it is behind. Multi-photon processes interacting with molecules is becoming history. Quantum entanglement, what it is going to tell us, I have no idea. The new generation will find out, will probably lead this. Therefore, what development takes place in physics immediately gets applied to chemistry and then it gets applied to biology. Now, with this as a background, I would like to tell you what I was planning to tell you under the title of quantum dynamics today. Since it is a school, please feel free to interrupt me anytime, ask me questions which I may or not be able to answer. Then, of course, I will promptly say it will be answered by Adhikari or Ashwini or Mahapatra. Now, Ashwini, if you will let me share my slide, just give me a minute. So hopefully I should be able to do that. I always have this problem.
Share the screen, you go.
Are we set?
Yeah, it's fine. Yeah.
Okay. Ashwini, I realize now it is 10:25. How much time do I have? Originally, I was scheduled from 10 to 11.
You take your time.
Time? Okay. So maybe I'll spill over by 10, 15 minutes. Okay. Now, so I am not going to get into what is quantum, what is dynamics. Those of you have been attending this school for the last more than two weeks. Therefore, you know what it is all about. Very quickly, let us recapitulate what classical mechanics does. In one line, it treats particles with a mass and position and momentum. You solve the Newton's equations, or you solve the Hamilton's equations. So Newton's equations is second order differential equation with respect to time. The Hamilton's equations, coupled equations. Each equation is first derivative with respect to time. So you have a dqi by dt, dpi by dt, rate of change of momentum is equal to the force, Now the Hamiltonian here is a sum of the kinetic energy part and the potential energy part. So if the potential energy is a function of position, then naturally negative derivative of the potential with respect to position gives you the force under which the dynamics takes place. Now, when you do this, when you solve this problem, when you solve the problem classical mechanically, Ashwini, you are able to see the full screen?
Yeah,
because here I have this thing, you know, coming in my...
You can just minimize that.
Yeah, mini...
You can hide it.
Hide it.
Yeah, that's what I'm trying to see how to...
So on the left-hand side, there's a dash. If you just click there...
Okay.
On the panel, it will hide.
Okay. That is my laser pointer was is interfering. So let me... Now let me minimize this. Yeah. Now it's okay. Now I can come back to my laser pointer. Yeah. So here, the force comes through the potential. And the negative gradient potential, it gives you the force, etc. Now, most important thing here is that you specify the initial condition by specifying position and momentum simultaneously. And you solve, either you solve the Newton's equations or Hamilton's equations or Lagrange's equation, depending upon your liking and convenience, you predict the future, you move forward in time, and you can tell what the past was by reversing the time. We will not get into the definition of time. We are staying in non-relativistic domain. Therefore, we will take time the way we understand. And the most important thing is it is deterministic path. You can predict the future with confidence. You can tell the past with confidence, provided you know the position and momentum simultaneously at any point in time. Moment you enter into quantum domain, the scenario changes. Of course, I may look silly for talking about it after having 2 weeks of the school. But for completeness, to get my symbols and definitions consistent with what I'm going to say, I'm going to go ahead and mention the time-dependent Schrodinger equation. Recently, Sushanto Mahapatra Dai wrote a perspective article in Physical Chemistry, Chemical Physics, where we specifically point out that Schrodinger did not write the time-dependent Schrodinger equation first. He wrote down the time-independent equation. I think he was probably wanting to show that quantum mechanics, the time-independent formalism, could give the eigenstates for hydrogen atom, and therefore the hydrogen atom spectrum could be explained, predicted and verified with the experiment. And then he did the harmonic oscillator, another bound state problem, rigid rotor, another bound state problem. And then I think it was paper 4 in that series, he talked about the time dependent Schrodinger equation because he had to deal with the scattering problem. And so we will leave that history there. Now for our purpose, what is important is that in a quantum mechanical description, you have an evolution operator which tells you how the system is going to evolve with time. If the Hamiltonian is time independent, the algebra is straightforward to show that the evolution operator is exponential in nature. If it is time dependent, you need to do a little bit of arithmetic. You need to have a time ordering operator so that you don't make mistakes, etc. But what is important is that the evolution operator is unitary. You can go forward in time, you can go backward in time. So and of course the norm is conserved. Basically that is what it is. If the wave function norm is conserved, naturally the evolution operator has got to be unitary. In some sense, the rest of the talk is all about how to solve this first order differential equation with respect to time. how to apply the Hamiltonian operator on the wave function, and thereby how to apply the evolution operator on the wave function. If you know where you start with, you know where you end up with. And sure enough, earlier days, we used to run the wave packet. I have not formally introduced the term wave packet, but let us say, if you went forward in time, you can run the same program simply by changing the sign of the time, t, and get back to the starting point. If you did, your algorithm was stable, your methodology was proper, was in order. You might have done other mistakes, but at least the time evolution part was done properly. Now, the reason one has to do with this was the Heisenberg uncertainty principle. If you cannot specify position and momentum simultaneously because Uncle Heisenberg said so, you cannot have the trajectories. You cannot have a deterministic system. The principle of microscopic reversibility is still valid. Except that you, in classical mechanics, in the principle of microscopic reversibility, you go forward and backward in time. But in quantum mechanical domain, physics, chemistry, or biology, you can start with the in a cell in phase space. This, you know, this for example, is a cell in one-dimensional problem. If you have only one variable, this phase space cell has an area h bar. If it is a two-dimension, you have the h bar square, n dimension, it is h bar n. So you can deal with whatever dimension you wish. You go from one phase space cell to another phase space cell, and you can go back. Even though the concept of trajectory is no longer valid, you can go from one quantum state to another quantum state, and you can time reverse and go back. So as far as this school is concerned, the quantum state is the key term. So you start with the state and you time evolve and you see where you end up with. Now for physicists, it's a perfectly all right to simply say, I start with the state one and go to state two. But for a chemist, immediately the question is, what is this state? Am I talking about reactants? Am I talking about products? Because chemistry is all about reactions. So you must transform a substance A into substance B, and they are different, chemically different. Now, so if you are starting with a reactant, for example, hydrogen plus oxygen, today it's fashionable to talk about conversion of hydrogen into water. It's like a clean energy, et cetera, et cetera. You generate hydrogen from water, applying solar energy, for example, and use the hydrogen to run your fuel cell. So if you want to study the hydrogen plus oxygen reaction, you need to know the initial state and the final state. Initial state is hydrogen in its vibrational rotational state, oxygen in its rotational vibrational state, and the product is water molecule in its vibrational rotational electronic state. You must keep in mind the electronic state. You must keep in mind the nuclear spin. All that has to be taken care of. So you can have several quantum numbers, electronic, vibrational, rotational, the projection, the nuclear spin, you know, what have you. You have to include all those factors, all those quantum numbers to define the state. I leave it for you to define. Doesn't matter what you do. The basic requirement is the same. You need to consider the Hamiltonian. You need to consider the kinetic energy part. You need to consider the potential energy part. Now, quantum chemistry in its development showed us, starting from Schrodinger. Schrodinger didn't have to worry about it. For hydrogen atom, the potential was already known. The Coulombic potential was already known. The real difficulty came when you went beyond hydrogen atom, many electron atoms, molecules. Your director, Dr. Saurav Pal, is an expert on this. But you need to use the quantum mechanics, solve the time-independent Schrodinger equation. And the bottom line is you get the bound states. bound states for the electronic degree of freedom, and then you solve the nuclear motion, you get the bound states for the nuclear degrees of freedom. And all that is required to specify the state of the system at any point in time. Now, here is the time-independent approach for completion. Here you have an eigenvalue problem. You know the Hamiltonian, you solve the eigenvalue problem, you get the eigenfunctions and eigenvalues. Now, for hydrogen atom, it is simple and straightforward. At least in 2021, it is simple and straightforward. It was not the case in 1921. 26 was when Schrodinger wrote his paper on hydrogen atom. So the kinetic energy, now the moment you are in quantum mechanics, you are dealing with operator, you have a kinetic energy operator, and you have a potential energy operator. The one thing difference between physicists and chemists is, physicists don't worry about the H bar, they take it as one, they don't worry about the mass, they take it as one, they don't worry about the coulombic charge, they take it as a one. And the chemists, of course, like to keep them all so that they know what they are talking about, they want to make sure that things are okay. So now for hydrogen atom, when you solve the time-independent Schrodinger equation, you get the bound states, those are the well-known hydrogen atom states. The lowest energy state, of course, Schrodinger solved Bohr's problem. Bohr did not know how these states came, and Schrodinger said, just if you apply the right mechanics, they will all come out naturally. Of course, you needed the input was the potential, coulombic potential. As I said, Schrodinger didn't have to worry about it. It was already known. And then, of course, the rest is all history. Moment to go to the many electron atoms. We don't have time to go into those details, and they are not, in some sense, not so important for today's discussion from morning till evening. But the fact remains that you have to worry about the kinetic energy part of the electrons and the potential energy between the electrons and the nuclei and the electron-electron repulsion. This was the difficult part, continues to be the difficult part when you want to go anything more than one electron atom. And the quantum chemists have mastered the technology. I'm using the word technology, the numerical methods, and of course using the appropriate computer technology, routinely solve these eigenstates for many electron atoms. At the end of the day, what you have is for a frozen nucleus, the nucleus is clamped, infinite mass, what have you. Of course, we are taking a finite mass when we talk about the reduced mass of the electron with respect to the nucleus. But what is important is that you only deal with the electron coordinates. You don't have any nuclear coordinates. The atom could be moving anywhere or could be stationary. Of course, it's incidental that there is no analytic solution, but they're reliable numerical solutions. There are people who have tried to work out analytic solution for helium atom. Now, when you go to a molecular system, now the problem gets complicated because in addition to the electron coordinates, you have to deal with the nuclear coordinates. Now, of course, you immediately know that you have to use the Born-Oppenheimer approximation, which says electronic motion and the nuclear motion are separable. But doesn't mean that you can forget one over the other. You will have an electronic part of the wave function, but it is dependent on the nuclear coordinate, what one usually says parametrically. And of course, you have to worry about the nuclear part of the wave function. So let us say first we want to solve the electronic problem for a given set of nuclear coordinates. Then you have to have the kinetic energy part for the nuclei. This is the electronic Hamiltonian I was talking about. Now you have, earlier we had electron-electron repulsion. Now we have internuclear repulsion. If you treat R as a parameter, this is a constant for a given value of R. You can treat it as a parameter. You can simply add to the electronic Hamiltonian. Now, what is important is that for the electron in the for fixed nuclei, that is the total electronic energy. To that, you add the internuclear repulsion. Now, this now plays the role of potential energy. The reason I said it plays the role of potential energy is that we are dealing with an approximation. And because of this approximation, we are able to define, we are introduced the concept of potential energy for nuclear motion. I am saying these words slowly and carefully because we pretend the nuclei as frozen, solve the electronic problem, and in the next breath, we talk about the nuclei moving. And eventually, if you want to study chemistry, you have to have the nuclei moving. You have to have the atoms and molecules coming together as reactants, transform and go into products. Now, let us, having introduced the concept of a potential energy for the nuclear motion by adding the internuclear repulsion, I have dropped the electronic nuclear, the nuclear charges here to the total electronic energy, you get the potential energy. So even today, in 2021, we generate this curve by solving the electronic problem for a given value of R. So what R equal to, let us say, away from, at infinity, you have a hydrogen atom and a proton. Let us say R is equal to 100 angstrom or 100 atomic unit, whatever. I solve the electronic problem. I add the internuclear repulsion. I keep doing this point by point by point by point by point until the two nuclei fuse together. So the H and H plus become a helium ion. The two nuclei have fused together. We don't worry about how they fuse. Conceptually, it is a Gedanken or thought experiment where the H2 plus becomes a helium plus. Incidentally, along this path, the conservation of orbital symmetry is obeyed. If you for the ground state, if you have the linear combination of atomic orbitals, when you fuse the two nuclei together, it becomes a 1s. If this has a cylindrical symmetry, this has a spherical symmetry, you know, topologically a cylinder can be squeezed into a sphere or a sphere can be transformed into a cylinder without introducing any node. If you introduce a node, of course, it cannot fuse together to the ground state of helium ion. It has to go to an excited state of helium ion. So the conservation of orbital symmetry is built in. Later in the day, Sushanta Mahapatra is going to talk about the Yontaler effect, what happens to degenerate states, how they become non-degenerate, etc. We will not spend time on it. But what is important is that if you obtain the potential energy for the nuclear motion, you solve the time-independent Schrodinger equation and get your bound states for the nuclear motion. Hydrogen molecule, forget about the blue one, just say, look at the red one. Here is the vibrational motion, the bound state for the vibrational motion of hydrogen molecule. Even though you generated this curve point by point by point, James Coulett did this in 1934 or something, 65, 66, Kolos and Wulniewicz did the ultimate, at least at that time, the ultimate calculation. Later on, Bishop improved it. So they improved all the relativistic part, etc. We don't worry about it. But what is important is that you are still in a time-independent domain and you get the bound states. So now we are in a position to define the initial state of a chemical system. You can define it as a vibrational state. You can, of course, do it similarly for the rigid rotor model or a vibrating rotor model and have the rotational states, et cetera, et cetera. Now, the curve that you faithfully calculate, what you normally call quantum chemists calculate this curve point by point, you need to represent it as a curve analytically or numerically. If you represent analytically, one of the 1928, you know, I mentioned some of these years because lots of things are developed very quickly, immediately after the initial papers are published. 28, Mohs had this representation of a diatomic potential, which was clearly anharmonic. If you truncate the Taylor series after the quadratic term, you have a harmonic oscillator. You know, often a physicist stops with the oscillator, but the chemist starts with the harmonic oscillator because he has to build the anharmonicity. Unless the bond breaks, there is no chemistry. If it is simply sitting there and oscillating, you can say, you know, when I say this chemistry physics, you know, please do not take my words in any offensive manner, because there is no distinction between the two. Some are trained as physicists, some are trained as chemists. Ultimately, both of us have to deal with the molecules. So the higher order terms are the ones which are the anharmonic terms. And I'm very fond of reiterating that bond is a dynamic entity. Even if you want to describe a hydrogen molecule sitting there and vibrating, you have to consider dynamics, because as the time changes, the internuclear separation changes. 1927, already the valence bond theory was developed for describing hydrogen molecule. And 1928, London gave a formula for a triatomic system. It's just a logical extension of this. At least for London, it was a logical extension. And this paper was written dedicated to their Guruji, Sommerfeld. Sommerfeld was a big boss at that time. It was 1935, 7 years later, Jonathan Slater, J.C. Slater, explained under what conditions you can get this formula. You know, this is like in mathematics. You can write down a conjecture, and somewhere along the line, some wise guy, some intelligent kid will come and prove your conjecture. So this equation was written essentially as an extension of this by London, one of the two authors here. But moment they wrote down this equation, whether it was valid or not valid was not so important. Eyring and Polanyi, Germany was a place where a lot of this action was taking place. You know, you have a Heisenberg, you had Max, you have Max Born, you had Heisenberg. And of course, Denmark was a little away, you know, just adjacent country. And Sommerfeld was there, and Heitler and London was working them. And people from the United States would come to Germany to do postdoc those days. Later on, of course, things changed. The reverse direction took place. Eyring had come to do a postdoc with Michael Polanyi, who was in Berlin at that time. This was before the Second World War broke. And assuming this ratio, they could evaluate this, which meant they could think of a potential energy surface, go beyond one dimension and look at the problem in two dimensions. We have the incoming, a hydrogen atom approaches a hydrogen molecule and comes over here and goes over as a new H2 molecule and a hydrogen atom. Of course, it goes through what is called a transition state. We don't have time to talk about it. And there are some artificial features here, not so important. And I think it was 2018, January issue, carried this article on Michael Polanyi. Sushanto Mahapatra and his student produced this three-dimensional perspective drawing of the potential energy surface for H3 system as we understand today. This is not the original surface. Remember, at that time, there were no computers, there were no computer graphics. It was all imagination. And with the imagination, with the imagined potential energy surface, they were doing imagined dynamics. And the first accurate potential energy surface was developed, produced by Sigborn and Liu in 1973. This Sigborn is the father, son of the father Sigborn, who got Nobel Prize for electron spectroscopy. This is a son Sigborn. Of course, son Sigborn is older than me. That tells you how young he is. Now, this is the approximately, if you saw the potential energy surface produced by Sushanto Mahapatra and his student, this was the representation in 1973. Now, this in 1930, having been given the London equation for the potential energy surface, Eyring and Polanyi wanted to study the dynamics. And one of the collaborators there was Wigner, a physicist, a chemical engineer turned a chemist turned a physicist. Now they said, look, if in the harmonic oscillator you solve a one particle, if you have a two particle vibrating, you can solve it equivalently as a one particle problem. Now here they have a three particles, a hydrogen atom and a hydrogen molecule. They said, look, if the three atoms lie along a straight line, then you can solve the problem as a one particle in two dimensions. In other words, they could modify the coordinates. How they modified the coordinates is not important. What is important is that they modified the coordinates and now they could visualize, they could not do any calculation. They could visualize the dynamics of transforming from reactants to products. Apparently, at some point in time, a few years later, Eyring and Hirschfelder in Princeton apparently thought that they could go to the football ground and mark these potential energy contours and kick a ball and have the ball, you know, coated with the chalk so that wherever the ball goes, you will be able to mark the trajectory. Just imagine how enterprising they were, at least mentally. If we didn't have computers, they were not waiting for the computer. They said, look, how can we do the problem quickly? How can we visualize? How can we approximate? That is how the dynamics, but they actually never did the kicking of the football in on a football ground. Part of the reason could be American football is not as simple as the Indian, the soccer, okay? Maybe that was a problem, I have no idea. But what is important is that they thought about it. A system that we have been working, when I joined IIT Kanpur 1978, I started working with this problem. Now, one of the speakers today is Dr. Satyajit Adhikari. He has been helping us, or I have been collaborating with him. We wrote some papers recently on helium H2+, and he's doing more calculations on the system. This is the potential energy surface. You start from helium and H2+, and you end up with the helium H++H. You know, the MBA graduates always, MBA guys always talk about a case study. So if you wish, here is a case study, how you do the dynamics. Now in this case study, we did the classical dynamics in the beginning. You can start helium and H2+ and follow the path. There is a little bit of a translational energy here, kinetic energy or translational motion here, and the vibrational motion is in this direction. As the molecule is vibrating, and the helium approaches, you move along this direction here, 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 here. And you go and you hit the repulsive wall and you can come back. That means we say, aha, no reaction. However, if you hit the repulsive wall and go over there, you end up with a product. You say, aha, we reach the products. Of course, there could be cases where it can come back. Now this in the modern terminology, these are chaotic trajectories. These are non-chaotic trajectories. Chaotic means you make one small change in the initial condition in the fourth decimal place and you can have a different dynamical behavior. Now, non-chaotic or regular means you can make changes even in the first decimal place. In the integral part, integer part, you can make change and still they all run parallel to each other, which means under these conditions, the dynamics is going to be complex or complicated. Shushanta Mahapatra had written a paper with me and Dr. Ram Ramaswamy long ago, how you can see the signature in the quantum world, how this chaos here could be seen in the quantum world. And if you are talking about entanglement, quantum computers, etc., you have to deal with this chaos in one way or the other, whatever language that you use. Now Ashwini is right in the beginning and said, today's discussion is all about wave packets. Now somebody has to introduce it formally, so let me do that here. What is the difference between a particle and a wave packet? A particle will have a mass, a velocity, a position, and a momentum. Quantum mechanically, you have to still live with the mass. You cannot dream, you cannot wish away with the mass. But since position and momentum cannot be specified simultaneously to arbitrary accuracy, You can talk about a range of position. You can talk about a range of momentum or velocity. So if you spread in the position space, then you would have sharp momentum. But if you are sharp in the momentum space, you would have a spread in the position space. Since Heisenberg has already said the uncertainty principle, it is a common practice to construct a wave packet. Wave packet is a superposition of waves, as Ashwini mentioned right in the beginning of this session. You have a superposition, both in position and in momentum space. As I said, if you freeze it in position, you spread in momentum. If you freeze it in momentum space, you spread it in position space. Now, which means you have to, now once you have the wave packet as the starting wave function, there are three steps involved. The first step is initial wave function. You need to know what the wave function is, time t equal to zero. Then solve the time dependent Schrodinger equation and study the time evolution of the system. And then after sufficiently long, now sufficiently long is where chemistry comes in. If you wait sufficiently long, the bond, old bond will break, the new bond will be formed. The old bond will break and no new bond will be formed, and many things can happen. So you need to know what happens to the system after some time. As I said, it depends. Time is a variable. If depending upon how much you wait or how little you wait, the final condition is going to be different. And for operational reasons, you need to have a coordinate. I mentioned about, for a diatomic potential, you have one distance. For a triatomic and line, you have the scaled and skewed coordinates that Polanyi and Irene came up with. For a non-collinear A plus BC system, you deal with the Jacobi coordinates, center of mass separation and the bond distance and the angle between them. Now, Satrajit Adhikari, Prashantu Mahapatra, they are experts in dealing with hyperspherical coordinates, which enables you to go from one reactant channel to another product channel or yet another product channel. So there is a progression of complexity as you go down this coordinate system here. Now, how do you represent the initial wave function? If you're dealing with an atom and a diatomic molecule, the diatomic molecule will have a vibrational state and a rotational state. And the atom approaches the diatom along the translational coordinate. It can be a minimum uncertainty Gaussian, for example. Here is the minimum uncertainty Gaussian. Well, you specify the spread, it's up to you. You do a Fourier transform, you get into momentum space. So here you have it in position space, here you have a Fourier transform in momentum space. And regardless of which one you are dealing with, you have a spread in energy. The spread in energy is dictated by the delta term. So classical mechanically, you may say the particle is at that point some momentum. So you can choose the wave packet to be centered at this momentum position at a particular velocity, particular momentum, and then you can consider the spreads. And of course, the first moment is going to be the same, both in the Ehrenfest theorem tells you that in classical mechanics, you can get the first moment, and that will be equivalent to the first moment in quantum mechanics, in the quantum domain. So when it comes to the numerical solution of the time-dependent Schrodinger equation, I already laid the ground. You have an evolution operator. For a time-independent Hamiltonian, you can represent it as an exponential operator like this. And for practical reasons, since the kinetic energy part and the potential energy part do not commute, the physicists would say kinetic energy is local in momentum space, potential energy is momentum is local in the position space. So when you want to operate on this on the wave function, this is very simple. But when you want to operate by this, because you are dealing with the kinetic energy part, you need to do some tricks. We will see the trick in a minute. to a second order accuracy, you can approximate the exponential operator of the Hamiltonian like this. This is called a split operator method. You can go to higher order methods. You can look at alternatives, but we are not going to. We don't have time to talk about them. What you do is you do one small step at a time. You know, like Neil Armstrong said, a small step for me is a giant step for the mankind kind of a stuff. You do it for one step, and then you can do all subsequent steps by repeating the process. Now, operationally, as I already showed you, you can have the wave function in position space. You can do a Fourier transform and get it into momentum space. You can do an inverse Fourier transform and go back to the position space. Now, the reason we are talking about the Fourier transform and inverse Fourier transform is that if you want to write down the kinetic energy operator on the wave function, you need to have a second derivative of the wave function with respect to position. In my earlier days, we used to use a finite difference method. But by the time Shwanta Mahapatra came to do PhD, it became standard practice. We didn't introduce, somebody else introduced the idea of transforming the wave function from position space into momentum space, in which case then you can differentiate it twice, which is equivalent to multiplying the Fourier transform obtained in momentum space by minus k square and doing another inverse Fourier transform. So you play with this. The reasoning is very simple. The digital computers enable you to do fast Fourier transform. In our days, we had to write the code, but today you can simply call the subroutine to do that. And you can just give the array of numbers and it will do the Fourier transform for you, and you can do the inverse Fourier transform. So they're getting second order derivative of wave function with respect to position became straightforward, and it was numerically accurate. As my friend Kozlov would say, it was decided by the machine accuracy. So once you know how to time evolve, you choose a coordinates. We are looking at the helium H2+. And as Ashwini said, all you do is to follow the time evolution of the wave packet. Remember, this wave packet that started off here was a product of the translational Gaussian wave packet and the vibrational wave function for the ground vibration state. You used it for the ground vibration state and the ground rotational state. So that, and this of course was a collinear problem, therefore the ground rotation state had to be ground rotational state. But you see what, you started off with the wave packet. It's almost like the trajectory going and hitting a repulsive wall and getting reflected. Like you know, you do ray optics, you get reflected by a mirror. Part of it went here and part of it came back. As a matter of fact, there are people who wrote papers in the late 70s showing how you can construct a potential energy surface in two dimensions, potential, like a oriented mirrors, and you can use ray optics, simply follow the trajectories, they are straight lines, because from here to here, just as one straight motion, and it's going to be reflected. If it is a mirror here, it will be reflected this way, this way. So part of it will go into products, part of it will come back into reactants. One of the students in our lab at that time, Balakrishnan, also calculated the flux, the quantum flux. Since you know the wave function, you can calculate the quantum flux. And he could show that if one could follow the motion like a fluid flow problem, supposing you threw a bucket of water, it will go there and get reflected, part of it splash here, part of it flash back. So what you saw, I'm going to run it backward one more time. So what happens is, this is a Gaussian wave packet. Now translationally moving, the reactants are coming together and they reach the inner repulsive wall. And part of it is going to the product. If you know how much went into the product, that gives you the reaction probability. If you know how much came back, that gives you the non-reaction or the inelastic transition probability. And as you will see, part of it will get stuck in the middle, which means part of it could be trapped in the region of the inner repulsive wall. We do classical trajectories, you can see the trapping and all beautifully, but it gets reflected in the quantum mechanical domain. Now, if you want to consider the problem in three dimensions, you switch to Jacobi coordinates, center of mass separation, the bond distance, and the angle between them. Now you are not dealing with a two-variable problem, you are dealing with a three-variable problem. Time is the fourth dimension. Of course, you have the computer graphics. I think this was produced by Aditya Narayan Panda, who is now faculty in IIT Guwahati. He made this, these cartoons, you know, the previous one as well as this one. It shows you how the dynamics can be followed by the same simple idea. You construct the initial condition as a wave packet, superposition of waves, time evolved, and follow the dynamics, and you know how much went into products, how much went into, came back into reactants. So final state analysis, and if you can calculate the probability by calculating the flux across a dividing line, then from the probability you can calculate cross-section, from the cross-section you can calculate rate coefficients, and the chemists of course normally call it rate constant. And the chemists are happy with something that can be observed experimentally in a reaction flask, something that can be measured in the laboratory if you have a molecular beam apparatus, and so on and so forth. So you can deal with the dynamics in a straightforward fashion. I just want to show you, I'm not going to do details here. So far what we did was doing dynamics on a ground electronic state. We did not talk about electronic excitation. If you go back here, for example, we talked about vibrational state, initial state. I did not tell you the final vibrational state. It need not be this zero. It can be V prime equal to 0, 1, 2, 3. In three dimensions, the product need not be in a rotationally ground rotational state. It can be J prime equal to 0, 1, 2, 3, etc. In other words, you can have a V prime and a J prime for the products. But all this is taking place in single electronic state, or what one normally calls the ground electronic state. And we had made use of the Born-Oppenheimer approximation. We did not talk about electronic excitation, but a lot of dynamics, photo excitation requires dynamics. You can start with the initial state in the ground electronic state. If you shine light, it will take you to an excited state. Here we are talking about instantaneous excitation, Frank Condon approximation, valid. We are not asking how much time it takes to from here to here. We pretend it is instantaneous, but this is governed by the transition dipole moment. The electric field vector that you are applying and the transition moment, it is the dot product of the two. It is what that dictates what was originally a stationary state becomes a non-stationary state. Now, this is as good a wave packet as you can get because it's a non-stationary state and it is going to be governed by this potential. Now, this, of course, is what is called a dissociation problem. Chemists call it a dissociation problem. The molecule fragments. So you have a photo excitation, you can have followed by photo dynamics. Now one can look at this problem, one talks about correlation function, etc. We don't have the time, we are just running out of time that was given to me. But what I want to emphasize is that you extend the methodology from the ground electronic state to the excited state. When you go to, this was a hydrogen iodide problem we discussed long ago, where there can be two excited states. This is a hydrogen and iodine coming in the ground state, or iodine atom coming in its spin orbit excited state here. And you can have a crossing between two electronically excited state. And there are several modifications that are possible. This is a case where a ground state and you have an electronically excited state crossing with a dissociative state. This is called a pre-dissociation. In other words, there can be a lot of interesting dynamics that can take place, not only in the ground state and also in the excited state, or more so in the excited state. Much of the excited state dynamics remains unexplored. The speakers, let other speakers today have looked at many of these problems. I leave it for them to describe them. So what I have done is to talk about the way we have been, people do dynamics, wave packet dynamics on a single surface. You can go to an excited state, but they're all within the Born-Oppenheimer approximation. When you want to go beyond Born-Oppenheimer, there are complexities. I see Dr. Mahapatra is going to talk about it. Immediately after me, Dr. Adhikari is going to talk about it. So I leave it for the experts to talk about them. And this will be shared with Dr. Tiwari. So if you want to know where what the references are, you can look them up. As I said, part of the Balakrishnan I mentioned, Mahapatra I mentioned, unfortunately, Chakravarti is no more. And that gives you the details of the algebra and how to go about implementing them. Ashwini, can I stop, share, and then ask answer questions?
Yes, sir. Yeah.
If somebody wants it, I can always go back to sharing.
Yeah, thank you, Mr. Satyamurthi.
Yeah, I didn't realize you were still there. I thought you might have had to go. And
No. I'm there.
Okay.
So I would like to have questions from anybody. If they have questions, those who are in the panel, they can also ask questions. Anybody can ask questions. They can unmute and ask questions. So I can start with one question, general question.
No.
That as far as quantum, are you going to ask Chiranjit Paul? Hello? Okay, all right. So I will start the question by asking something that in the electronic structure theory, we at least understand that there is a superposition of states for the wave function, and depending on number of superposition of states, quantum information can be passed more effectively and so on. So when you talk of dynamics, I'm just trying to see how it can be used. Is it in the same way that you have a Gaussian wave packet? You take a combination of the Gaussian wave packets, and but then are these Gaussian wave packets, will they be like qubits? So they will become like qubits, right? Individual states, I suppose.
Let me say the following. Qubits part, I suppose one has to deal with them because you will have a superposition of states, and if they are coupled, you have to deal with them, except that so far we have not talked about it. But people, you have been collaborating with the Cederbaum's group. What's his name? Koppel, Cederbaum.
Hans-Dieter. Koppel, Meyer. Are you talking about Meyer?
Meyer. Meyer has been a pioneer.
Yeah.
Where they talk the same language they use, multi-configuration, approach.
Right.
MCTDH. So time dependent Hart tree. Yeah. So because we don't have to worry about, in principle, you should be able to do with the FOC also if you want to anti-symmetrize the nuclear wave function with respect to spin, right? After all, the protons, hydrogen molecule, for example, the protons are fermions. Shushanto can tell you whether anybody did TDHF for the nuclear motion. So the equivalent concept is there. So the MCSF is very much there. And except that now you are dealing with different configuration. They are not electronic states, but they are nuclear states.
Yeah.
Yeah, nuclear in the sense without considering the spin and other ramifications. Yeah.
So to make them relevant to quantum information, I suppose they will be those nuclear states will become the qubits. That's what I was.
I suppose so, because they are, they can take you to the kind of picture that we had, I have described is all right for a 3-atom, 4-atom problem. But when you go to larger systems, polyatomic system, naturally those tools are important. Yeah.
Right. So, yeah, that's what I would feel.
Yeah.
That the, because eventually there has to be relevance from the point of view of quantum entanglement.
See, moment you do a photo excitation, that simple curve that I had, moment you do a single photon excitation and go to the excited state, right? Now the time evolution is going to be governed by the coupling between the two states.
Yeah. I had another related question, the dynamics, that's the time evolution.
Mm-hmm.
Will that have, if that can be exploited in the quantum information, that is the evolution of the quantum information also has a dynamics, how the information is passing. So I was thinking that the dynamics can be directly relevant there.
See,
which is not in the realm of electronic structure. Yeah.
Yeah. Well, there are some papers of ours which get quoted many times, whether people read that paper or not. And there are some papers which people don't quote at all. One of them I did with Balakrishnan was maximization of entropy during chemical reaction.
Yeah.
Since there is a spread this is immediately following what Dadre used to do in Pune. I simply copied.
Right.
Since the wave packet is spread in position space and momentum space, we calculated the information theoretic entropy. See, what happened was when I went to do PhD, the statistical thermodynamics course, the thermodynamics course did not have the usual textbook. I had a teacher who taught it out of I forget the name of the author, the information theory, information theory was used for getting all the thermodynamics. Berlin was the book that I used as a textbook. And initially I did not appreciate what I was getting from my teacher. I said, why is he talking about all this stuff? Because I was used to the conventional, thermodynamics and statistical thermodynamics. But it was a godsend because I learned the information theoretic concept right in 1972. Therefore, it was easy for me to adapt and calculate following the prescription of Gadre. Actually, I just threw away the book, The Thesis of Sears, which had looked into the information entropy in position space and momentum space and showed that it reaches a maximum when the chemical reaction is over. We asked a question, you time evolve, when do you stop the time evolution is somewhat arbitrary. So we used the information theoretic entropy as a tool to decide when to stop. If it reached a maximum, that means no further time evolution. But as I said, I don't think many people have quoted this paper, but immediately relates to the quantum information that you are talking about. But this is, of course, just for the ground electronic state. Now, today, until a couple of years ago, I used to say you need to work in up to femtosecond only. And I thought beyond femtosecond, there will be no chemistry. But today I stand corrected. When you go to attosecond, you have a superposition of electronic states. You know, the delta E, delta T uncertainty relationship comes into picture.
Yeah, right.
You compress the pulse in time, you spread the pulse in energy, which means several electronic states are going to be involved. So it's going to be a very interesting problem. With Raphael Levine, we are trying to do this problem for carbon monoxide, CO. Balnarayan, whom you know very well, is helping us calculate the potential energy surface curves until the ionization limit. So there is enough work for chemists whether they contribute to quantum computing or they use quantum, sooner or later they will use the quantum computing, I can assure you.
That is for sure. Yeah, that is for sure. We are certainly going to be the major users of quantum.
I think so.
So can I comment on this?
Yeah, please. Ashwini, you are the best.
Ashwini,
So basically, when you do the dynamics, when web packet is propagating, you can basically control the phase of the different component of the web packet. And therefore, you can look at the constructive and destructive interferences along the when the web packet is moving. And that will basically correspond to the different gates and different. So you can use it as the quantum theoretic informations. So that's what many of the people do in the quantum information. They propagate the web packet and they look on the signature of the interferences. And they use it at the gates in the different quantum information techniques.
Okay, yeah, that's right. That's what I thought, So any other question?
Yeah, in that paper with the Balakrishnan, we showed the constructive and destructive interference between the incoming flux and the outgoing flux. And actually, when you organized a meeting in Puri, one of the members in the audience asked me whether those interferences were energy resolved. I could not answer that question. It needs a revisit to the problem by looking at the energy, what Ashwini is describing. If you do it on an energy resolved one, then you will be able to precisely point out the phase involved.
Okay, yeah. Good. Any other question? Professor Panigrahi, you wanted to ask something?
I wanted to ask this thing, maybe a comment also, that in fact, D-wave quantum computer precisely uses this, dynamical evolution to compute, the problems, in a basically Ising model, evolves it in time, and comes out to the solution. As Ashwini pointed out, this phase thing, these are actually finding use in quantum computation. Web packet evolution is
I remember there was a meeting organized in Kolkata by the Bose Institute. At that time, Sudarshan had come, and as a chemist, I naively made a statement. You can see how silly I must have looked. Because when we did the rate constant calculation, phase was not important. When you do several averaging, the phase effects get lost. But for physicists who deal with the individual states, the phase is very important. Yes, I agree with the thanks to Dr. Panigrahi for his comment.
Thank you. Are there any more questions?
Maybe students should ask the questions.
Yeah, is there any students who would like to ask the question? You can unmute and ask.
There should be active participants, otherwise this is like no meaning. The students are not asking questions.
Yeah, I do not know how to make them ask. Usually, they all wait for one person to ask, then they ask. Okay, from my side, the offer is that if they want to send me a question by email, they are free to do so. Yeah, I'll be happy to answer them.
Yes, sure.
Today and beyond today also. Yeah. So I want to thank you all for giving me this opportunity.
So I think Satrajit has a question, maybe. Satrajit, let's see.
It's not.
Satrajit, before I forget, there is one question that has come up in the chat box from a student, Dibbendu Saha. So he's asking, why there is no analytic solution for a many electron atom?
Saurav, you are the right person to answer that question.
No, it's a good question. But yeah, indeed, it is not possible because of the electron-electron repulsion term. The analytical solutions have been very, very difficult. People have tried, however, with a wave function which explicitly includes the what is called the electron-electron distance, R12 or Rij. And there have been some efforts, but again, it is basically like a power series method. It's a brute force kind of power series. I don't know if you would like to call it analytic solution, but it's basically a power series method in which, again, the infinites, if you go up to almost infinite powers, a very large enough power, you get exact solution. But the kind of question that you're asking for, like hydrogen atom, you have an analytic solution. Yeah, that is not possible for many electron atoms because of that term. Yeah, I mean, Professor Sutamurthy, would you like to add?
I just wanted to compliment what you had said, that 1/r term is the one that gives difficulty. as the one of the early books on quantum chemistry, Eyring, Walter Kimball, goes into that, which of course you have already explained it. You do a Taylor series expansion of it. You can get a convergence, but getting convergence is not the same as getting an analytic solution. Your friend in Taiwan, right. Your friend in Taiwan was trying to work out some
up to 50
terms or some up to 50 decimal place, the correct answer for helium atom. I remember.
Helium atom.
I remember. I listened to him in one of the meetings. Maybe it was the meeting you organized in Puri. He had organized and he had come.
Probably it was in Goa.
Goa, I think. Right.
Maybe it was in Goa.
Good. Thank you.
So another question is asking Pragya Kumar, why we always talk about SWE as a time independent SWE? What if you consider time dependent SWE? What chances we'll see?
Well, the C part I do not know. Actually, this is the introductory remarks Shrantu and I make in our perspective article. A friend of mine asked me this question long ago. Why add an time as an extra dimension when you can answer all questions by solving the time independent Schrodinger equation? Ultimately, you know, probability is a transition probability. And then, of course, by the kind of a description that we have done today, it tells you as to why you need to include time. But when we are told about Schrodinger's discovery, we are told about the electromagnetic waves that Schrodinger was talking about and then wrote it by looking at it kind of a stuff. We skip steps there. In electromagnetic wave, it's a second order derivative with respect to time, right? Saurav, in Maxwell's equation, you get the second order.
I
think you and I have said, somewhere he says, I think we consider a four-vector formula.
Four-vector formula. So I think he's probably talking about relativistic, I think. I'm not sure.
Then you need a spin R. You need include the spin. Yeah. But I have already declared right in the beginning, we are dealing with a non-relativistic domain.
Yeah. Satrajit, you wanted to ask something?
I'm not asking anything. I just feel to make a comment.
Yeah.
And regarding the point that discussion was going on earlier, regarding the spin and the qubit and the quantum computer, and nuclear dynamics kind of thing. So the electronic spin, and that has immense role, and that's why you have to develop Slater determinant, you have to do entire spin orbit, and an entire, you have to handle the spin of the electron through post-Hartree-Fock all static correlation, dynamic correlation, everything. But in the nuclear case, there is one thing, probably everybody you remember, that Martin Quark he find that what is the role of nuclear spin? It appears in the spectroscopy that the nuclear spin has a role, but it is almost at the level of 10 to the power minus 11 joule per mole. Okay, so almost nothing. On the other hand, the internal rotation, when you do the reaction dynamics, internal rotation along with the three-body rotation, sometimes it creates the reaction, as for example, the ozone depletion reaction, ozone reaction. I have seen that it behave like a bosonic, when pseudo-bosonic particles, okay? So in that sense, it can act as a cuboid, for specific reactant and product, but generally nuclear spin role, of course, is there, but it is really feeble, nuclear spin.
Mm-hmm. Okay. So, would you like to say anything, Professor Satyamurthy?
No, he has already said, I just wanted to mention, while the nuclear spin does not play any important role, but when it comes to ortho-para-hydrogen kind of a situation, which Satyajit already alluded to, then you have to explicitly take care of the nuclear spin and the consequent symmetry aspects. Yeah.
Good. Okay. So I think we are almost running out of, we have run out of time. That's for sure now. So I don't know if there are any other person who would like to have a pressing question. The host or the students, anybody?
You can go to the next speaker.
Yeah, otherwise we'll close the session.
Yeah.
And let me thank once again Professor Satyamurthy for initiating the discussion on the quantum dynamics. There will be other speakers, but most importantly, giving a very extensive overview of the field and where it started and where we are today and how it can play a very important role in quantum information and quantum technology. So thank you, Professor Satyamurthy, as usual, for a very nice talk, very exciting, good talk.
Thank you. Thank you, Ashwini and Prasanta. I would now mute myself and stop my video also.
Yeah. Okay, thank you. So I'll hand it back to Ashwini.
So, Sir Panigrahi, hello?
Ashwini, yes.
You please chair this session.
I thought Professor Paul will chair it.
No. So you please chair this session.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you, Professor. Yeah, it's a pleasure to introduce Professor Adhikari. And, he has been associated with us. And as you will see, the kind of thing he's going to talk about has deep implications for quantum information theory. And, it's very useful to design artificial gauge field. This kind of tactics is being used in cold atom to generate artificial gauge theory. So many aspects of it you will find direct relevance. And you will soon see the kind of, mathematical muscle power and kind of understanding Dr. Adhikari brings it to the subject. So, he's from cultivation, but he also has been associated with us. And we have had the good opportunity to hear him several times. And his clarity is something to be appreciated. So, Professor Adhikari, this stage is yours now.
Yeah. Welcome, Satrajit.
Thank you.
Welcome.
Thank you, Professor Panigrahi, Professor Paul, for inviting me and for this opportunity when a lot of good people are talking and giving a lot of forerunning topics and discussing to the student. So let me share first the screen. So the topic is, I hope I will get at least 45 minutes. So now it is 11:35. Okay. So what I will be talking essentially that the role of electron-nuclear coupling in triatomic reactive scattering processes. And of course, I belong to Indian Association for the Cultivation of Science, but I also belong with ISER as adjunct professor there. Now, electron nuclear role of electron nuclear coupling, okay, in the reactive scattering. So let me define the problem first. This is a cartoon, essentially, okay? Not actual situation I will be coming. So if you try to see the bond energy, and then you can see as a function of bond distance. And let's say this is the ground electronic state, and this is the first excited state, okay? And if it can be situation like that, and there can be very, very common situation where these two states can be touching each other, that kind of situation as a function of bond distance and energy. So if the molecule jumps from the ground electronic state to the first excited state, then the well-known concept people used to describe, that is called Frank-Condon transition. Now, Frank-Condon transition implicitly tells you that the nuclear geometry is fixed, and so point group concept is preserved. That means whatever point group you are using to define its irreducible representation of that molecule or of that point group. And also, point group has an advantage that the symmetry operator commutes with the Hamiltonian. And since it commutes, you can say that they will have the common set of eigenfunction, and that's why you can do symmetric LCA combination and generate the symmetry adapted linear combination you can make and form the molecular wave function also. And that is in a column, the first column, you implicitly actually assume that you are in Born-Oppenheimer approximation, which Professor Sottomurti was talking. Now, as soon as, you know, that kind of situation happens, you have somewhere a conical intersection, that is two surfaces touching each other at some point, or this concept is no longer valid if you think, then nuclear geometry is no longer, you know, fixed. When the molecule jumps from the ground electronic state to the excited electronic state, its nuclear geometry also changes. So it generally deviates in all kind of dynamical situation. And therefore, you know, the molecular point group is not there. The molecular symmetry groups comes in. So the corresponding irreducible representation has to be defined with this commutator, that is Hamiltonian, molecular Hamiltonian commute with the operator, and that is traditional symmetry operator multiplied by the, you know, rigid rotation of the molecule in the three-dimensional space, that is Euler rotation, and the nuclear permutation. That's the way the symmetry elements define. And that is where, unknowingly, if you follow this prescription, you are in beyond Born-Oppenheimer regime. Okay. Now, if you want to study the beyond Born-Oppenheimer regime, then actually you have to study from the beginning of 1937. And this is the two physicists, Jahn and Taylor. You know, the physicist way of doing what they do, they say, what happened if there is two electronic state which are essentially degenerate, just to show them different, I put something plus epsilon and minus epsilon, and one is, you know, minus epsilon, that curve, two-dimensional harmonic oscillator, that is the red one, and the excited state, that is the green one. Okay, otherwise, if you put epsilon equal to zero, they will merge with each other. And if you want to break that kind of, so there is a degeneracy among these two electronic states. In the chemist language, these are, you know, E prime or T prime or E double prime, like that, you know, irreducible representation. And now you bring in some sort of coupling among those states. You see the off-diagonal element is zero, so they are decoupled. You sort of, you know, coupling, which in chemist language, that is the ligand. You know, if some ligand come in, if you have some, you know, degenerate d orbitals, and then you have, you know, T2G and EG set, you know, and the T2G is dx square, dxyyzzx, and T2G generally you say dx square, y square, dz square. And then the ligand come, and then ligand create the splitting. And if the ligand give a linear kind of coupling like that, where this linear term are, if you write in polar form, then, and if you diagonalize this, if this matrix, if you diagonalize this matrix, then you get some modified kind of coupling term between the, and that is plus minus kr, and r is root over x square plus y square. And you plot them, then you get this kind of thing, which is called conical intersection at this point. So ground electronic state is looks like a Mexican hat. The excited state is, and you can see at this point, basically two inverted cones, one cone and then another inverted cone is touching at a point, okay? And this model actually used by Van Vleck, Harvard University, and explain the so-called Jahn-Teller distortion of the compound hexaco copper complex, how the elongation and compression of the bond happened. And that was up to 1937. And then if you take a cross-section of this figure, take any cross-section for a fixed X or fixed Y, then if you take fixed X, then along the Y, something like that, then you can see, the ground state is like that, okay? And the excited state is like that, okay? And that is the point of conical intersection. That is the point to electronic state are degenerate. Now you see, if you look at previous figure, so the minimum was at center, at x equal to 0, y equal to 0. Now look at that. Here the minima is away from the center, and the minima has been stabilized by an amount that is k squared by 2 m omega square, where its potential is half m omega square. This is harmonic, and this coming because of the linear coupling kr. Kr I defined plus minus kr. When it is minus, it is the lower curve. When it is plus, then it is upper curve. You are adding with the harmonic term, okay? Now you see the what is the amount of distortion? Distortion is k by, m omega. You just have to take derivative and equate to zero. You find where the minima reaches and how much stabilization happened. And that was up to 1937. And then it was a keep quiet for a long time up to 1961. And what happened? Longetkin's came in picture. He tried to find out the eigenfunctions of this Hamiltonian, And it is very easy. You take 10, 15 minutes to find out, maybe even less. It can be done maybe any, first year level master student. And you can find these are due to eigenstate. But what it, pointed out by Longetkin's that surprisingly, this eigenfunction changes sign while going from 0 to 2 pi. That means the eigenfunction become multi-valued because 0 and 2 pi are the same point in the configuration space. At 0, the value of the eigenfunction is 1, but at 2 pi, the value of the eigenfunction is minus 1. So it become multi-valued. So the degeneracy, when you have degeneracy at a point x equal to 0, y equal to 0, that's the point where you have degeneracy. And at that point, because of that degeneracy, you get some eigenfunction which are multivalued. And when you have multivaluedness, the basic axioms of quantum mechanics is violated. And that's create a, enormous problem in the community that what happened, what will be the eigenfunction, and what can be done if there is an eigenstate among the electron, if there is degeneracy among the electronic state. The solution was ad hoc by Longetkin's. He said, okay, you multiply some phase factor e to the power plus minus I theta by 2. You see, this theta is basically a nuclear coordinate. So this is theta and r, basically polar transform of the two nuclear coordinates. And this is one electronic state, and this is another electronic state. This is ground, this is excited, and they are coupled like that. So you see the nuclear wave function become multi-valued, and how to solve it? You ad hoc way you solve, you multiply by a plus minus I phase factor phi by theta by 2. And now you can put theta equal to 0, then e to the power 0 is 1. And if you put theta is equal to 2 pi, then you get plus or minus pi, and e to the power pi is cos pi plus I sine pi. sine pi is zero, but cos pi is minus one. So that's how minus one multiplied by minus one, you again reach to plus one. So that's how he taken care of the phase problem. So that is also later, you know, Michael Berry called geometric phase for, you know, this is for molecular system, but he bring all kind of thing for magnetic field, for electric field, all kind of situation. So this is the molecular phase problem. So you can understand the molecular phase and the phase problem. Michael Berry is bringing in 1984, but that was in molecular system in long before, that is 1961. Even Pancharatnam said about this phase in electric field, you know, light interaction, intensity interaction. He faced that in much before, that is 1956. Now, so in our, you know, study is molecular system, and we find that the nuclear wave function get a sign change whenever there is a, you know, conical intersection. Now, I and my students, what we tried, so later try to calculate the electronic wave function, and, you know, to see the electronic wave function, you have to do some technically smart thing. You have to write the electronic wave function on the scratch of the computer. And we started the sodium 3, which is a D3H point group, so-called. And by the way, I'm giving you information for sodium 3 is D3H, and there is four conical intersection between the 2E prime state and the lower 2E prime state. And one of the conical intersection has a D3H point, and another three at C2B points, okay? Now, if you move adiabatically, that means you remain on the ground electronic state or first excited state of the doubly degenerate E prime state, and write, keep on writing the dominant coefficient of the electronic wave function, you do some kind of MRCI level of calculation, very accurate calculation, you try. And then you see the dominant coefficient. You see, when I follow by the red curve, the D3H conical intersection, you see there is a single sign change. That means the electronic wave function also sign changes whenever there is a conical intersection between the 2E prime state. But if you follow the two, if you encircle two conical intersection, like here, the blue one, you see ultimately there is no sign change. It starts with positive, it ends with positive. So finally, there is no sign change. So for an odd number of conical intersection, if you encircle, the Longetegen's theorem has predicted there will be a, you know, sign change. But for even number conical intersection, if you encircle and follow the dominant coefficient of the electronic wave function, there will be no sign change. So you can understand, you know, in our previous thing, the nuclear wave function changes sign because of the degeneracy. The electronic wave function changes sign because of the degeneracy. So can then be something which is even more general? Yes, the even more general is beyond Born-Oppenheimer treatment, not approximation, okay? Treatment, first you have to understand what is treatment, and then you go to the approximation. So beyond Born-Oppenheimer treatment is on the molecular Schrodinger equation. This Hamiltonian is the molecular Hamiltonian where you have two part, because he considered the kinetic energy of the nuclei as a perturbation. It was a right reason to consider as a perturbation, because in the mass of the nuclei is in the denominator, and which is generally 1,836 times heavier than the nuclei, a electron. So therefore, this term will be very small, okay? So you can treat as a perturbation, and then the electronic Hamiltonian, which depend on both electron and nuclear coordinate, that Professor Sottomurti was showing that you have nuclear repulsion term in the electronic Hamiltonian. And then if you use, you know, there is something called double perturbation. Once you consider only the electronic Hamiltonian and expand around the equilibrium geometry of the molecule, then you get some kind of solution, order by order solution for the nuclear wave function. and also you consider as a perturbation this one, and then again you do the same perturbation. So it is called double perturbation, and that he did in 1937. And then you find out that if you consider a parameter that is kappa to the power 4, which is a extremely intelligent consideration, that what should be the perturbation of the switching parameter of the perturbation theory for his specific this problem, and that is mass of the electron divided by mass of the nucleus to the power 1/4, because you find, if you consider here, here is the kappa to the power 4, you can separately write up to the second order, but kappa to the power 4, separately write the electronic wave function and nuclear wave function, which nuclear wave function contain both the vibrational wave function and the rotational wave function. So you can write separately as a product form. So the writing product form, the nuclear and electronic Schrodinger equation, that comes under the consideration that the molecular wave function is expanded up to second order, both the and then you consider a parameter that is kappa to the power 4. Then you do double perturbation. Once you expand the electronic Hamiltonian, only electronic Hamiltonian up to second order, and find the term by term solution for the nuclear wave function and the electronic wave function. And then you consider the second perturbation, where you consider the kinetic energy of the nuclei as a perturbation with a switching parameter that is kappa to the power 4, and kappa to the power 4 is a very, very genius choice. That choice tells you that at least up to second order, the total molecular wave function can be written as a product of the electronic eigenfunction. You see, this n is the electronic quantum number, and the nuclear wave function, where nuclear quantum numbers are there, both as a vibration and the rotations. Okay. So what is said, that whatever you lose up to second order, that can be balanced if you cover the entire Hilbert space. So the total molecular wave function, you write as a summation over all the combination of the molecular wave function for each state, and then you write as a combination of the product of the electronic eigenfunction multiplied by the nuclear eigenfunctions or wave function, and which he called Born-Huang expansion in 1954. So now there is no difficult to understand, even if there is a sign change in the nuclear wave function, like here, and even if you have sign change in the electronic wave function, like here, there is no problem because they come as a product. So ultimately, 2 minus 1 gives you plus. So finally, the wave function will be single value. So the problem is not there actually. Now, if you consider this expansion, that is what is called Born-Huang expansion. The beginning, it was actually Born-Oppenheimer treatment, and then Born-Huang. If you consider this, this expansion, and for bookkeeping, if you consider the number of electronic state is equal to 3, okay? And then I can repeat, that is the molecular Schrodinger equation, that is the Born-Huang expansion for the 3 electronic state, 1 to 3. You consider that 3 electronic state form a sub-Hilbert space, because you assume that for this case, for our present case, the rest of the electronic state are far, far, far away energetically. So they will not interact with each other within this subspace you consider for considering 3 electronic state. And as usual, you consider the total Hamiltonian is sum of the electronic Hamiltonian, which depend both electronic coordinate and the nuclear coordinate, where nuclear coordinate act as a parameter through the nuclear repulsion term and the nuclear kinetic energy term. And also you consider for each fixed nuclear geometry, you have the electronic Schrodinger equation, and the electronic Schrodinger gives you electronic eigenfunctions and the so-called adiabatic potential energy surface, the potential energy surface which depend on the nuclear coordinate, and that's you have seen in every textbook, even for a diatom, what you see in a the low value of the bond distance, you have a repulsive part, and there is a minima, and then it goes dissociation. Because so that kind of curve is UI. You know, it will be complicated, it will be surface for three atom, and then it will be hypersurface, you know, so on as the number of atom increases. Okay. So if you substitute all these three equations in the molecular Schrodinger equation, the first equation, and if you do some manipulation is very simple. You have to, you know, project out by the electronic eigenfunction from the left hand side and integrate over the new electronic coordinate. So what you do, let me repeat, you substitute all these three in the molecular Schrodinger equation and project by electronic eigenfunction for each electronic eigenfunction for the three, you know, Saville-Hilbert space electronic function, you can consider construct three.
There is a question, so you can respond.
Yeah.
In the chat box, there is a question.
Okay.
From the Payal Roy, the wave function will form stationary, that's what then. So that's the question.
Wave function will form stationary state then. Wave function will form stationary state then. Oh, no, still I am. Yes, okay. My answer.
Can I unmute and explain your question? Hello? Payal, can you hear me? Hello. Anyway, you can explain. I don't know what.
I think she is saying it will be stationary state, right?
I am still in the electronic structure domain, so that means I am handling only with the electronic eigenstates. Okay. So when I will be going to do, you know, with this potential energy, so when I come in this equation, so then the nuclear wave function on the process of dynamics, that will create stationary state or, you know, virtual state, all kind of state. But as long as I am handling only with the eigenstate, so because we have the solution of the electronic Schrodinger equation from the Hartree-Fock or post-Hartree-Fock method, I get the electronic eigenfunction and substitute all these in the molecular Schrodinger equation, you get a nuclear wave function. Nuclear Schrodinger equation. Now, this nuclear wave function can form stationary and virtual state and all kind of state, all kind of situation while doing the dynamics. But still, I am in the domain of eigenstate of the electronic eigenfunctions. Okay. So now, if you project by the electronic eigenfunction from the left hand side, on this equation and integrate over the electronic coordinate, you get a nuclear Schrodinger equation. The terrible thing happened, the first term is the kinetic energy of the nuclei operating on the nuclear wave function, and this is the adiabatic potential energy surface operating on the nuclear wave function. But the next two terms are terrible term. These are basically coupling between the two electronic state I and J through the nuclear kinetic energy, so-called Laplacian gradient operator and the Laplacian operator. So that is where the electron-nuclear coupling comes. My topic is electron-nuclear coupling. Now, if these terms are zero, then you are basically in the Born-Oppenheimer approximation. If these terms are non-zero, or the problem is something that is such that it is non-zero, then basically you are beyond Born-Oppenheimer regime. So it is not your choice. It is the natural problem. Somewhere it will be zero, somewhere it will not be zero. Particularly if there are multiple electronic state situation where the electronic states are degenerate, they are automatically non-zero. So you cannot make them zero. There will be coupling between electronic state I and J, where I and J are within one of the two states within a given Saville-Hilbert space. Now, this is basically, you can form a divergence equation from here, because if you take a gradient on that, you can find that the, you know, the first order coupling and second order coupling, this is basically called divergence equation. But that has the advantage that first order coupling and second order coupling are related with each other. And moreover, the advantage is that you can substitute in this equation and replace everything with the first order coupling. Now, in this equation, you can write in the matrix form. As I said, it is three electronic states are involved. So it can be like that. Now you see the coupling among the electronic state is through the kinetic kind of coupling. And that kind of coupling is basically you have seen between the two electronic states through the nuclear gradient operator. So, and the potential energy are diagonal, and these are called adiabatic representation and adiabatic potential. 99% case in the textbook, they are discussed about adiabatic potential energy surface, which are basically solution of the electronic Schrodinger equation through Hartree-Fock and post-Hartree-Fock method. Now, the problem is here, this coupling between the electron nuclear state. And the one of the issue you see, this coupling term is Q-symmetric matrix. And you know, if you want to diagonalize a Q-symmetric matrix, automatically you know it gives complex eigenvalue. So there is a possibility that that gives a phase factor. Because if you diagonalize, if there is a way of diagonalizing the such Q-symmetric matrix, you get a complex eigenvalue. And you know, it will be like a vector potential here. And then when it is a vector potential, you rewrite it as a phase form. So it gives a phase kind of thing. So now I am not going in that direction, but let us proceed in different direction. The direction mainly I want to talk, that is if you consider again the electronic eigenvalue eigenfunction equation and take a derivative by the nuclear coordinate. Okay, so this is, you can see, you solve by Hartree-Fock or post-Hartree-Fock method, electronic Hamiltonian, and these are the eigenfunction of the electronic, basically electronic eigenfunctions. Now you take a derivative with respect to nuclear coordinate, because electronic Hamiltonian is depend also parametrically at least, and if the parameter changes very fast, you know, then you can take a derivative with respect to nuclear coordinate. And if you do little more manipulation, which is called using Hellman-Feynman theorem, you can show the non-adiabatic coupling term is basically something in the numerator and then something in the denominator. And denominator is basically two excited or ground electronic state, two state, electronic state I and J. Now, if there is a degeneracy, it will blow off. So it says that this non-adiabatic coupling term could be singular at certain point of the nuclear configuration space because of the degeneracy among the electronic states. And how to handle infinity? No, that is actually traditional way. It is very difficult to handle infinity in finitely large quantity. So therefore, the solution of such equation is virtually appear to be impossible, except you can be happy, forcefully neglecting those terms. But you don't know when those terms are very large, particularly, you don't have molecule or, rarely available molecule when you do not have degeneracy, okay? So almost every cases, those terms are important and those terms are large. But there is a one way in 1890, and that is Cauchy's residue theorem. That tells you that if you have a singular function and you can apply, some kind of, Professor Panigrahi was telling, you can apply some kind of gauge theorem, and such singular functions can be n pi, okay? If it is n pi, so you can move from a, singularly large function to some finite value, but at the same time, the equation will be gauge invariant, and therefore, your observable, calculated observable will be same. Now, the problem is how to do this, show this gauge invariance, and how to apply this Cauchy's residue theorem. One of the way of applying is that you consider the adiabatic Schrodinger equation and then apply some arbitrary transformation matrix from adiabatic representation to diabatic representation, something. So far you have no idea what is adiabatic transformation. But if there is a transformation, and that transformation can bring from this kind of Schrodinger equation, which is kinetically coupled to the potentially coupled, you can do it, but under a condition, okay? What kind of condition it is? That is grad of A plus tau A. Tau is the non-adiabatic coupling. A is adiabatic-diabatic transformation matrix. I have no idea so far what is that. And then you, if you equate to zero under that constraint, you can reach to a diabatic surface. And you can see that if you come to this form of this matrix element, you can see those are some kind of angle, okay? Some kind of angle, and I have shown you those angle can reach to 0 to pi or 2 pi or something. So those are finite values. So what you can do, you can hide those singularity in the form of some angle, and those are angle basically telling you the mixing angle between the different electronic state. Namely, theta 1,2 and theta 1,3 basically are the mixing angle between state 1 and 2 or 1 and 3 or 2 and 3 like that, okay? So that way you can go to the adiabatic to diabatic representation, but the singularly large values can be removed or hide, and it is an exact way of hiding, okay? So that is one way, but what is the condition? The condition is this one, and that condition was talk about Bayer and Topf in 1977. You can see the gap. Long Ettingen's talk about 1961, and then a long gap, you know, and everything later on after Long Ettingen's is based on Long Ettingen's angle. I mean, Mead and Truller, all thing, gauge invariant, gauge, you know, vector potential, all these are basically reminiscent of Long Ettingen's space. But the after that, the first development was Topf and Bayer. What he said, under that condition, you can transform. And what are that kind of equation he said? He said, you can, if you write with some, you know, so-called rotation matrix, Euler kind of pseudo-Euler matrix, then you can get some differential equation, which are vector equation. Of course, if you have two coordinates, there will be six equation, and the non-adiabatic coupling term. And the non-adiabatic coupling term, you can calculate by ab initio electronic structure calculation. Because electronic structure calculation, if you go back and see carefully, this, what are those form? You see, these are electronic state that you can calculate from post-Hartree-Fock and Hartree-Fock method. And you know what is your gradient operator. So you can numerically take the gradient and calculate those non-adiabatic coupling term. And then therefore electronic structure, you get the electronic eigenfunction operating on them, you can get the non-adiabatic coupling term, and then you can substitute those and find this adiabatic-diabatic transformation angle. And many years later, actually, again, there was a long gap. We came up with a equation which is a reminiscent of those equation, and that gives you explicit form of the non-adiabatic coupling term. And you see the non-adiabatic coupling term are basically vector. Since these are basically molecular vector, so it creates a molecular field. Since they are vector, you can have divergence and curl equation, and that helps you to simplify the nuclear Schrodinger equation, okay? So, you can see you have the curl equation. So all these things you can have. And with that, you can simplify the nuclear Schrodinger equation. I am not going all these. But there is a possibility now. You can do your things in an exact manner, and you can reach to the diabetic Schrodinger equation, and you can do your dynamics. Now, this process has been coded in last 20 years. I have been working in this area, and this has been extended for any number electronic state, any number of vibrational modes, local modes or normal modes or scattering mode, and that kind of thing. We have interface with all kind of standard packages like Gaussian, Molpro, and other packages. So from there you can get the input, and this package will give you diabetic surface. This program is appear in GitHub as well as this Journal of Chemical Theory and Computation. So that program can be downloadable, and this program automatically can access the standard quantum chemistry package and get the adiabatic potential energy surface and non-adiabatic coupling term, and then it automatically constructs the diabetic surfaces and on which you can do your dynamics. One of the important thing which I cannot tell you in details, but the one of the problem is that since these equations, as I showed you, those equations are basically differential equation and multidimensional equation. In order to integrate those, you have to take a path. Which path you will take? Okay, because contour integral, you have to take a path. Now there is an infinite choice of path because you start with this nuclear configuration and want to calculate the diabetic surface along this path. Or somebody can tell, no, I can choose this path. So what will happen? So you have some, for non-abelian means when you have, n greater than 3, so more than 3 electronic states are coupled, and the adiabatic diabetic transformation matrix is Euler kind, pseudo-Euler kind, which I am talking of SO3. Now for that kind of situation, you can analytically appear that the two transformation matrix hold a relation like that, where in the exponent you have curl of the non-adiabatic coupling matrix. Okay. Now, if you take this matrix as a product like B, and if you do B dagger B, you can find that is a unit matrix. That means A1 and A2 are related through another orthogonal matrix. Therefore, either you calculate observable by using what you do, this adiabatic diabetic transformation matrix you use here, and you construct your diabetic potential energy surfaces. So whether you use A1 or A2 doesn't matter, both the diabetic surface will give the same observables. That's what we want to mean here, and we have proved also with several examples, and not only model but also real ab initio constructed diabetic surfaces. Now, if you talk about these angles, and if you do real calculation, like, let us consider NO3 molecule, and there are some degenerate asymmetric stretching mode, if you consider for that, and this molecule has 5 electronic states of Hilbert space. So it has so many number of angle. For each pair of state, you have an angle. So you can see that theta 2, 3 reaches to pi when you go 0. If you integrate those adiabatic diabetic transformation equations, when you go from 0 to 2 pi, it reaches to pi, or some angle reaches to 2 pi, or some angle reaches to 4 pi. But now I can tell you what is the difference. Similar example, for trifluorobenzene, and here I have considered 6 electronic state, and this is A+H2 reaction. Now for this, see, the difference of our phase, which is basically topological phase, and the Michael Berry's phase. Michael Berry's phase is basically, or Longet-Higgins phase, is just like if you plot that phase as an angle pi, it is just a straight line, okay? The angle versus angle. But in our case, the phase is basically reaches to the final form, integral multiple of pi, but it is and it changes from molecule to molecule. So it depends on the topology of the molecule. And some detail I am telling about A+H2, where 3 electronic state, the interaction between F and H2 when they react and they form FH. Okay. So in the diabetic potential energy surface or adiabatic potential energy surface, you get Jahn-Teller and Rehner-Teller conical intersection and one Rehner-Teller and Jahn-Teller. So therefore, this phase reaches to three pi. But Jahn-Teller pi and Rehner-Teller 2 pi. So ultimately reaches to 3 pi. There is other thing I want to tell you. That is basically, you know, two theorem. One theorem tell you if you move from, because you see, you are now in beyond Born-Oppenheimer regime. Your no longer point group is valid. So how do you find the irreducible representation of the non-adiabatic coupling term, which you have calculated from ab initio program? So there are two theorem. One theorem tells you that if you arbitrarily start with the irreducible representation of a non-adiabatic coupling for a particular degrees of freedom, you can find the non-adiabatic coupling, irreducible representation of the other degrees of freedom of the same non-adiabatic coupling. Now, the arbitrariness of the irreducible representation, because that is important, because you have to consider such that diabetic coupling finally have to A1 symmetry. Otherwise, they will not remain coupling. So all you know the irreducible representation of the adiabatic potential energy surface, you have to find out the irreducible representation of the non-adiabatic coupling also. Then accordingly, you do all kind of correction, you know, some sign correction will come and then you can reach and get a finally corrected diabetic surface, you know, in an exact way, so-called exact way. Now the arbitrariness will go, because if you starting irreducible non-adiabatic coupling term, if there is a conical intersection, you can get plus or minus n pi. Okay, I forgot to write here n. So that's the way you can find out that what will be the starting irreducible representation. Now, once you know for a particular coordinate irreducible representation, particular non-adiabatic coupling, there are other theorem, which is basically direct product kind of irreducible representation theorem. And that tells you that you can find out the irreducible representation of the other non-adiabatic coupling term for a given Saville-Wirth space of a nuclear Schrodinger equation. Okay, these two theorem actually first proposed by Long-et Higgins in 1963, and then used by John Munge in Michael in 2010 for a system of C2V. Now we have applied, because we want to do for triatomic reaction, we have applied this D3H. We need to construct the reconstruct, because you see the elements are different. Okay, and then we can find out the irreducible representation and the generating function, and therefore you can calculate, you can correct their, you know, nodal pattern of the functional form on the in the configuration space of those non-adiabatic coupling, and you can say elements are defined like that. They are usual, you know, symmetry operator, rigid rotation, and nuclear permutation. So that is actually very difficult to construct this, character tables. But you need to do to find out where the generating function belongs. Now, once you do that, you can find out for sodium 3, these are ab initio calculated non-adiabatic coupling for tau rho and tau phi. And then you have to apply this kind of, Long-et Higgins, so-called molecular symmetry, and you have to correct it, their sign according to the nodal pattern. And with that, you can plug into the adiabatic diabetic Schrodinger equation, and you can get the angle. And then with that angle, you can calculate the diabetic potential energy surface. Now, quickly, I will show the two applications, the major applications, H3 plus, the potential energy surface, we construct at the very, very accurate method, MRCI level, 2 electron distributed in 10 active orbitals and 56 number of configuration state functions using, PV5Z quintuple zeta basis set. And then first 3 electronic state we have considered and calculated the adiabatic potential energy surface in terms of hyperspherical coordinate. There is a advantage of hyperspherical coordinate, because hyperspherical coordinate, all the reactant channel and product channel, even-handedly handles, okay? And not only that, when you go and do reaction dynamics for multiple electronic state, in my opinion, that is the, if not the only way, but I can say that is the only most accurate way. Otherwise, you will have problem whenever you do reactant to product transformation. Okay. Now, AC plus some elementary things I can tell you about the surface. You can see this is the entrance channel, and this is the conical intersection between the first electronic state. And you can see, you know, there are all the things, and you also, it matches with the conical intersection, also matches, you know, is 2.16 electron volt. And it, you know, this is very, very accurately matches all this quantity with the standard thing. And this is the other channel, and you can see other channel. There will be three channels, okay? One will be reactant and two will be product, okay? So now, if you look at even more detail of this, you can see that H3 plus has a minima that also matches. It is 9.313 with respect to the entrance, H plus H2 kind of thing. And with respect to the entrance of H2 plus H plus, it is basically 4 point something, and the H2 has this dissociation energy. H2 plus is 2 point, because I am considering now three electronic state in my dynamics. And H3 plus, as I said, is minimum with respect to the entrance channel, it is 4.58, but with respect to the you know, asymptotic region of the H plus H and then H dot, like that, if you consider, and that is actually 9.316. And these are the, you know, conical intersections. The blue line, the green line shows the conical intersection between the first two electronic state at C2V point, and the first and the second excited state has conical intersection at D3H point, okay? First excited state and say. So this is the, essentially we pointed out first time about that. And these are the non-adiabatic coupling for a particular rho. Rho is equal to 10, rho theta and rho phi. And you see how large they are suddenly happening. So these are basically singular functions, okay? And now we transform to the diabatic. And as I said, there will be six crossing between the first two electronic state. You see the blue line, you see these are zero. These are contour plot. So blue lines are zero. So that means the two surfaces are crossing, okay, at rho equal to 10, okay? Now, if you do the dynamics, I'm not telling about the dynamics code, but I can tell you that time-dependent hyperspherical coordinate, our code is the first time worldwide, and that actually can handle for entire set of angular momentum. And for D plus H2, you have three processes: DH plus plus H, reactive charge transfer process, and then H2 plus D, non-reactive charge transfer process, HD plus H. So reaction happen, but charge, reactive non-charge transfer process, RNCT. So all these process, we handle, you know, calculated the diabetic surfaces. I'm not going detail about this. We closely solve about, you know, exactly nearly 1 billion coupled differential equation, extensively parallel code we have, and I have shown here how parallelize is made and for as a function of total angular momentum in hyperspherical coordinate. And then we solve this 3x3, you know, diabetic Schrodinger equation, and we calculate integral cross section with this, you know, you have this, you know, the probability factor, which probabilities which you can calculate from the amplitude of the wave function. And once you have the, you know, the integral cross section, you can also calculate the rate constant. So this is the first calculation on this system, D plus H2, and this is adiabatic calculation. That means on the ground state. Now you can see for the ground state, integral cross section and collisional energy. You can understand how many differential equation we have solved. I mean, you even cannot count, okay? And actually, you know, it need to be highly parallel and a good machine like a Cray, okay? And I'm lucky that ISCS, we have it. And now you can see that is other people's calculation, something Chu and Han. and dive on the adiabatic surface. And our calculation is this one, and you see the experiment how nicely matches. But there are some, but some these mismatch also there. This is on the ground electronics. See, you see, we have, losing the slope. The experimental cross section has a higher slope. We have lower slope. But when you do the three state diabetic calculation, then you can see that our calculation is really matching with the experiment within experimental bar. All other theory is far away, actually. Okay, for RNCT, for RCT is also extremely good agreement. And we have, you can see here, you can see this kind of article and experiment in a molecular beam experiment you have YT Lee's experiment, you have other people experiment like that. And this many number of differential equation for rho, theta, phi, and the three surface, and the number of J is 2, and then real imaginary. And I didn't write the Lanczos iteration. Now this also, this also we have done with actually Michael Baer, and this reaction we have done from the same surface, but from the excited electronic state, okay? Because this kind of reaction happened because, the earlier reaction happened, the H plus H2 in the dense cloud medium, basically, okay? If you want to connect with nature, but this reaction happened in the diffuse cloud medium, and people want to have its rate constant, particularly for weather forecast and many other things. So there are a lot of people have attempt to find it the rate constant. Now you can see in our method, the integral cross section came like that, and 25 years back, Michael has this data, integral cross section. Okay, and Michael was interested, to what would be the actual rate constant if we use our modern surface and modern, time-dependent program. Now, this is the present, if you, this is electron vibrational rotational eigenvalue, okay? All, if you want to get all kind of complicated eigenvalues problem of the surfaces, then you see there is a crossing between the first excited state and the ground state, okay? And the crossing happened between third and fourth vibrational state of the ground state. There's some differences, whatever Michael Baer and Last is used, but they are close, but not exactly close. You have to understand our surface is at the MRCI level, highly accurate, and that is 25 years back, and also Dean constructed diabetic surface. The construction of the diabetic was also not that accurate. Now the rate constant, we find out the rate constant, and since it is a barrierless reaction, so it follow the perfectly Arrhenius rate constant profile. This is present calculation, and then we compare with the experiment. So over the temperature range 250 to 1000, if you calculate the rate constant, if you take an average over that, this is usual, our natural temperature range. Beyond that, it's not generally nature, okay? So we get 8.93 10 to the power minus 10 rate constant. But experiment, it is 6.4 plus minus 2 into 10 to the power minus 10. You can see it is the closest calculation so far on this system, the in terms of theory. And now maybe I have 4 or 5 minutes. I can see I started 35. So, okay. Just telling A plus H2 very fast within 2 minutes. That is also a reaction between, between the involving electronic state A1, at 1A1, 2A1, and A prime, and we did the same kind of procedure, MRCI level of calculation, and very accurate diabetic surfaces. The details of the diabetic surfaces is already published. Someone can look into that, and we find that, there is spin orbit coupling between F can be half and 3/2. So that also included, relativistic effect. So when you consider the entrance channel along the collinear geometry, the, you know, the pi state and the sigma state, they are like that. Sigma and pi state can have a conical intersection even with the spin orbit coupling, without coupling also that, and that's the overall collinear geometry potential at the surface. The non-adiabatic coupling, the JT coupling for rho equal to 7.5, and this is the, you can see it is reaches pi and 2 pi kind of thing, okay? If you look, A plus is to have a Renard Taylor at theta equal to 90 degree at collinear geometry. So one dimensional plot at rho equal to 14 Bohr and theta equal to 81, close to collinear geometry, the Jahn Taylor goes to pi and Renard Taylor coupling goes to 2 pi. So everything actually, the surface now is very, very accurate. Now with that, and this is the spin orbit coupling, of course, is very small. It is only 200 centimeter inverse, which you can include like that way to construct the diabetic surface, only 0.02448 electron maximum value. So that also we have now. Now we have started the dynamics, and that's my last presentation. You can see that, you know, this many you have to do solve. And the blue one is Werner calculation. And we have the similar kind of resonances for when you do the adiabatic calculation. 0.25 to 0.45, low energy collision, okay? J equal to zero situation, Werner and hour. And this is the diabetic surface, okay? Excited state product, F star plus H2, their case is like that. Our case is coming like so different. So that's why we are fumbling. We are trying to do the same dynamics. Now we have done FFT Lanczos. Now we are trying to do Dewar Lanczos. So that this feature coming out before we go for publication, we want to, because this is substantially different, it is coming from the Werner calculation. Now, this is for different J, total angular momentum, is for adiabatic calculation. For adiabatic calculation, our integral cross section is very good, existing, because adiabatic ground state calculation is already there. So all the existing has good agreement with ours, or ours has good agreement with all others. Our has improvement with the MRCI level of surface, and the relative integral cross section for the vibrationally resolved integral cross section, that also agrees quite well. The red one is ours. So that is where I stop. So essentially what I did, that I show you an exact way how to form the diabetic surfaces for a reactive chemical reaction, where you have reactant, you start and go for the product. And in the process, you will face the coupling between the electronic state, which is singular, how to avoid that and what are their properties. And it changes from one system to another. And then finally construct the diabetic surface. And then you calculate the integral cross section probabilities and rate constant, and try to go back to the molecular beam experiment and try to see how much is agreeing. It appears the agreement is excellent. Okay. And we are, and every calculation takes 2-3 years for a surface, because you understand it is closely 1 billion coupled differential equation you have to solve. Okay. So, my thanks to my collaborators, Michael Baird, N. Sotomurthy, who is another, who was first speaker, and then Antonio Varendas, Natalia Provalova, is from Russia, Lebedev Institute, Sam Sundar from Isar Kolkata, Isar Mohali, and then Rahul from St. Xavier's College. He's a computer wizard, parallel program developer, and all my students, and thank to DST for funding and ISES for Cray supercomputing facility. Without this machine, I do not able to present so much of data, that for sure. So thanks.
Thank you, Professor Adhikari, for a very nice and rigorous talk. Very eye-opening. Now the session is open for some questions. People can ask directly. So maybe can I ask one question?
Yeah.
Yeah, it looks like, you know, the way you are treating that very potential, that gas potential, it is a local gas theory, isn't it?
It is local gas theory. But
maybe
no.
That potential, you know, that non-Lagrangian.
You are right. It is local gas theory.
Yeah.
But because the conical intersections are localized. Okay. But when the conical intersections are localized, then that point you have to make sure that your coupling between the electronic state follow the gas.
Okay.
If it doesn't follow, the entire thing is lost, actually. The rest of the thing doesn't matter for you. Okay.
If students should ask questions.
Yeah.
So there is a question from a student. Yeah. Please, you can read the question and answer.
Stop sharing.
Yes.
In the chat box, there is a question.
I want to know your comments on why a quantitative treatment of the Jahn-Teller effect is more challenging than qualitative treatment.
Yeah. You see, the qualitative treatment just for qualitative understanding, of course. But then the entire set of modern experiments, like merge beam experiment, molecular beam experiment, you know, Professor Sotomoti was telling, you know, the Y.T. Lee, the Polanyi, you know, the entire, you know, the second half of the last century was basically second by this kind of experiment, Y.T. Lee, you know, Dudley Hertzberg and Polanyi. And those are molecular beam experiment. And molecular beam experiment, rate constant and cross section, how do you consider, calculate, you know, try to understand the mechanism, what is going on inside, without doing a theory where you can handle Jahn-Teller and Nellert-Teller quantitatively. Unless you handle quantitatively, that's what I was explaining Professor Panigrahi, that even though they are local, but if you cannot include them properly, then everything is messed up. And then with those surfaces, if you do your dynamics and calculate the probabilities, and then the cross section and rate constant, those are all messed up. That will not agree with experiment. Okay.
Okay, I don't see any more questions. So thank you, Professor Adhikari. And meanwhile, if you have some semi-popular kind of thing where things have been worked out a bit more explicitly, if you can send us, we'll put it, because some students are interested to work out things, including me also.
Oh, I have actually, you know, I am your adjunct professor. I am okay. Adjunct professor. And there, I used to give a course on Beyond Born-Oppenheimer that is, you know, much more lucid than this thing. So that thing I can give you.
That would be nice. That would be nice.
That is basically a course on, you know, so it is much more lucid than everything, because I teach it within 50 lectures or something, you know. So it is 300 pages or something. It's a long note. But it is slowly developed.
So only some problem is really benefit from it.
Only problem is that is highly involved. I mean, that you cannot avoid, because here you involve in between gas theory and divergence and divergence theorem and curl and divergence. So that actually definitely for physics student that is no problem. I'm 100% sure, but the sometime chemistry student, they avoid this in the, you know, bachelor's kind of stage, and they have to little bit go through in the vector algebra and come back and see the note. That's what I can tell you.
Okay.
Yeah.
So thank you again, and we'll now go to Professor Ashwini Tiwari's talk. I hope Sangeeta is around.
Thank you, Satrajit.
Thank you. Did you like it or not?
Thank you.
No, did you like it?
Yeah, of course. Yeah. I've heard before, but I think for some students it may be a little technical, but that is good. That's good hearing. Yeah.
No, very, very nice talk. Every time I listen to Satyajit, I learn something more.
Yeah. So that's good. Very good.
Thank you, Sati.
Yeah.
Pleasure.
Satyamurthy, I also liked your talk.
Thank you.
Aswini, you can... Sangeeta, I hope you are around. Aswini, you have... Yeah, Sangeeta.
Yes, yeah. Thank you for the task of being moderator for Mr. Aswini Tiwari. So, Professor Tiwari, I guess you can start sharing your slide. So he is an expert on quantum dynamics of simple reactions, and he does, and this study extends to atmospheric chemistry, gas solid, as well as heterogeneous catalysis, and also laser molecule interactions. So the chemical reactions are simple, but they have wide application, and they're also experimentally verifiable. So I hope we shall have an interesting talk.
Thank you, Sangeeta, for the introduction. So from the morning, all of you are listening about the quantum dynamics. So I will start from the very basic things. And before I start, let me thank Sir Panigrahi for giving me this opportunity to talk about this wave packet dynamics things in this quantum information, quantum technology school, because chemistry is a bit off from this school, even that he all the time he involves us in this school. So thank you very much, Professor Panigrahi. So let us start with the time-dependent Schrodinger equation. And in the last two talks, all of you listen about this. So I'm not going to talk about this, but if you look on this, we have two variables. One is the position, other is the time. And if you look into the solution of this differential equation, we go our basic and we use the separation of variable, and what we do, we assume that solution of this can be written as the product of two functions. All of you can see my slides?
No.
No.
You need to see.
Oh, so I've not seen it. So I have on and share the screen. And then share slides. We have to go to the now. Is it visible?
No, not yet.
Not yet. So how to do? So I normally so how I what how?
So when you click share screen, there are all the videos open on your laptop, and then you click on the one you want to share, and then share.
That's what I did basically.
No, it's not working.
Let me go again. Share screen.
Sometimes if you have it maximized in a different window, it does not show. So maybe okay. You bring it to the main window.
Now it's visual?
Not yet.
No, we don't see it yet.
Don't see the my slides?
No.
Very strange.
Maybe you can come out and try again.
From the...
Must be some problem. You can come out and log into Zoom and try again.
Yes, we see that.
It's okay.
Good, I can see it.
Sir, you can do full screen. Yes, sir, it's perfect now. Yeah. You can unmute yourself.
Okay. So I will start from basic. So here is the time dependent Schrodinger equation, what we are listening from the morning. And if your Hamiltonian is the time independent, you can do use this evolution operator to evolve in time. So I'm not going to talk of this evolution operator at this moment, but let us talk about the solution of this Schrodinger equation. And if you take the two variables problems, we can, so somehow my slide is not changing. Oops.
Maybe try without making full.
Yeah, maybe, yeah. So now it's, I think it should be okay. So if you look on this and I go to the next slide.
But we don't see your screen.
Oh. It says screen sharing has failed to start. Oops. Sangeeta, can you see my slides?
Yes.
No, okay. Go full screen. Yeah.
Full screen. Somehow the next screen is not working. So I will work.
We will live with this. Yeah.
So if you let me, I will start with this time dependent Schrodinger equation, and then I will try to look into the solution of this in one variable in position and then time. So what we do, as usual, we do from our basic, what we do, we assume the solution as the product of two functions, one in the position and other in the momentum. And then we take this and go and put into time-dependent Schrodinger equation, and you can separate the time-dependent Schrodinger equation in two equations, one in time and other in the position. So this will be basically if you take this and put into the time-dependent Schrodinger equation, you will get this one, and you will get the one in time and other in the position. And this is the usual time-independent Schrodinger equation. And this is basically the kind of differential equation which we get in the time. and we try to solve these two equations. If you solve this equation, we get the basically the eigenvalue, eigenfunction equation. So we get the eigenvalues and eigenfunctions. And like the, if you solve for the hydrogen atom, we'll get the hydrogen atom eigenvalues and eigenfunctions. And if you solve this one, this is basically the initial value problem. So we get the, if you know the initial value chi naught, we'll get the basically the one phase factor. So we can calculate the chi t at different time. And if you solve this one, we'll get basically the, all the eigenvalues. And therefore, the solution of the time-dependent Schrodinger equation will be nothing but the product of these two solutions. So we can write down the total solution of the time-dependent Schrodinger equation, phi e x, which is basically the eigenfunction of this time-independent Schrodinger equation multiplied by this time-dependent factor. And of course, this is a chi naught is basically a constant multiplicative factor that we can basically figure out that value by the this normalization constant. And if you look on this, and if you look on the Born interpretation, and look on the probability density, we'll get basically the something which does not depend on time. So basically, if you look on the solution of this time-dependent Schrodinger equation and use the Born interpretation to calculate probability density, it does not depend on the time. So then you ask the question, what about the time in the quantum mechanics? And then the answer comes something called particular solution and the general solution. Because these are basically nothing but the particular solution of the time-dependent Schrodinger equation. And quantum mechanics say any linear combination of this particular solutions are also a solution of the time-dependent Schrodinger equation. And therefore, if you took the two-state problem, we have this psi xt, which is the, if there are two state, one state has energy E and other state has energy E prime, then the a solution psi xt, which is the linear combination of these two state or these two functions, one phi E prime x multiplied by the phase factor because of the E prime, and other one because of the first factor phi ex, first eigenstate. And if you take the linear combination of these two, that is also a solution of the time-dependent Schrodinger equation. Now you calculate the probability density. What will happen? We have the psi xt whole square. Now we have the first two factors, they are time-independent, but the last factor, which depends on the interference between the first two factors, that will depend on the time. And this is where the time plays very, very important factor. So superposition state, that is also known as the wave packet. If you are dealing with the superposition state or the wave packet, you have to involve the time-dependent Schrodinger equation. Here, the time plays very important role. So if you are dealing with the any superposition states, that is also called the wave packet, you have to deal with the time-dependent Schrodinger equation. That's what I have written here. In the EVF equation, first two terms depend on the psi e and psi e prime, and the third term depends on its interference between the psi e and the psi e prime. This interference term is the result of the superposition of the eigenstates with different eigenvalues, and that is basically the, this superposition state is called the wave packet. And we will see that in the quantum information theory, this wave packet is a very, very central role. So in, you will see the recent literature, people try to see how the, by controlling the relative relative phases between the different component of the wave packets, one can basically perform the quantum information operations. So that's what I will basically show in the, and let me make this statement also. All the time dependence of the psi xt square is contained in the interference term, and hence one can say that a wave packet is required in order to have the time dependency in the probability density and in other observables. So whenever you are looking for a time dependent phenomena, you need to have to create the wave packet. So all the time dependent phenomena comes from the wave packet character of the your function. So whenever you are looking for a time dependent phenomena, you have to construct the wave packet. And in general, the general solution for a time-dependent Schrodinger equation, like earlier I showed for two state, in general we can write down the, if you have the n state and the particular solution for the n state is this, you can take the linear combination of all these states and you can write down this. This will basically the a wave packet. So this superposition state is a wave packet, and you can play around with this wave packet to get different exotic phenomena in a given system, molecular system or atomic system, whatever the system you are dealing. And I will show one example basically. Let me show this paper. So I took this from the recent physical review, it came from in 2004. And what they have done basically, this experimental paper basically, what they did basically, they took this wave packet of rotational wave packet. So there is a system, and then they create a rotational wave packet in the system, and then they control the relative phase of the different different components of the wave packet. And from there, they get the quantum information kind of tricks. So let me read the at least abstract, although the details I don't understand, but what I can say, lasers can create rotational wave packets in gas phase molecules which periodically revive as a field-free aligned distributions. We control the wave packet evolution with relatively weak laser pulses at fractional revivals, which modify the phase between the wave packet components. We demonstrate two-phase control effects in oxygen, coherently switching revivals off and on and doubling the revival frequency. When viewed as a quantum logic system, the effects correspond to the head mod and the T operations. So forget about the last line, but what I wanted to convey by simply playing with the phase of the your wave packet, you can basically perform many, many quantum information theory operations. And this is what they are doing in this. So basically you, by controlling the phases of the wave packet, or relative phases of the different components of the wave packet, we can basically, we can enhance the, we can control the constructive, destructive interference, all kind of things you can play around with the wave packet. And what is the technique? Basically laser. You can take the laser, we excite the wave packet at different times, and therefore you play around the wave packets, you play around the interference between the, let me show the this slide. Like this one. So suppose you have in the ground state, sitting in the ground state of the molecule, and then you are exciting the from the ground state to some excited state, and you excite bit by bit. So the ground, whatever the wave function has gone to excited state, and the next time, what are the wave function come, it will go and interfere with the wave function which has come earlier time to unexcited state. And simply by delaying, by playing the time interval between the first step wave function and the second step wave function, you can play around with the this term, the last term. And therefore you can control the basically the interference and phase, and then you can play around and you can do all kind of the quantum information experiments basically, and that's what they have done. So the reason I wanted to show it, this paper, that the wave packet had very, very, very important role in the quantum information theory, and therefore one needs to understand the wave packets in details if you really want to do the quantum information. In fact, if you look on the quadrant control in chemistry, it exactly corresponds to what you do in the quantum information. So in the quadrant control in chemistry, we basically play around with the phases between the different component of the wave packet, and we control the wave packet. And in quantum information also, you play around with the different phase of the component of the wave packet, and you do the different operation. And I will show very basic example, particularly a box. And I will show you how this, the last line they say, by changing the frequency, doubling frequency, doubling of the revival frequency, you can basically look into the different operations, change the look and into the different operations. So let me show the basically the parking a box example that will clear how you can play around with the phase. So suppose this is the, you have a box, parking a box with the length L, and suddenly you make it 2L. So what will happen when it's the length? So this is a flexible wall. So when the length is L, so this ground state wave function basically eigen state, so this will not move with time. But moment view, basically you just make it 2L. Suppose you made it 2L, what will happen? This state is no more eigen state for the bigger box, and therefore this wave function will start doing the oscillation. It will start, so this is no more eigenstate for the bigger box. It will be a superposition state for the bigger box, or it will be having a wave packet, and therefore it will start doing the oscillation inside the bigger box. And you will see that if you want to understand the dynamics of this wave packet in the bigger box, you will see that as this wave packet moves, it will keep on changing its phases. I will show how, and you can do it basically analytically, very simple way. So I am talking about a ground art function. So for the old box, your eigen function is nothing but this one. Now this wave function, eigen function, become the superposition state for the in the bigger box. Therefore, this you can expand in terms of the eigen function of the bigger box. And therefore, I can write as the sum over all the states of Cn, phi n, and then I ask the question, what is the period of oscillation, how it moves, what is the dynamics of this wave packet inside this box. And one can basically call, one can do derive analytical formula, and one can plot it and see, one can actually see the its moment and see how it's moving and changing its phases, coming back to its original place and then going back to the some other part and so. And then this change in phase can be basically correlate with the different operation in the quantum informations. So basically what you can do is very simple mathematics. So you can write down the wave function, wave packet of the old box at any time t, either sum over all the wave function of the bigger box eigenstate, and then of course you have to, if you want to at a given time t, you have to multiply by the phase factor. If you want to at time t equal to zero, you have to basically put the time t equal to zero. So you know this, and then of course this, all these coefficients, you have to basically calculate this integral, get all this coefficients value, put it there, and you'll find that if you go up to A9, basically you will get saturated. So you don't need to go beyond A9. And once you get it, and I ask the question, what is the smallest period of oscillation for this wave packet? And you can basically go and calculate the, put this phase factor 2 pi n and just compare with the initial wave packet, because that at the when first type cycle is over, the initial wave packet and the final wave packet should be exactly the same. Therefore, you can write down this equal to this, and then you will find out the period of oscillation is nothing but the 60 ml square by h pi. So if look on this box, which I showed earlier here, this will start moving, and after 60 ml square by h pi, again it will come back to this. I ask the question, how to look at after tau by 2, half period, and we'll see that it will look like, you can exactly put the time tau by 2 in the this equation, and you can find out the how the wave function looks at the time tau by t equal to tau by 2. And you'll find that it will look like this. And you see how it's changing. So initially the wave packet was at the left-hand side and the phase was in the positive direction. And after tau by 2 times, it has gone to the right-hand side and the phase has become the opposite direction. So it's basically changing its phase. And therefore this change in phase can be correlated with the some kind of operators in the quantum information, and this is what is done basically. And I will show that we exactly do the same thing in coherent control of the chemical reactions. And I have many examples to demonstrate it, but I will not go because we are already running late in time. So I will show only one example. I have many examples, but I will go to the, let me see. So let me show the at least example. Like this is one example. So this example basically HOD molecule in its ground state. And just if you take the delta pulse exciting the first excited states and look on these two channels, H plus OD and D plus OH. And the since OH bond is weaker than the OD bond, and because of the kinetic factor, the ratio of these two channels is always more than 2. And if you excite with the delta pulse, this channel is preferred by 3 times compared to this channel. And whatever the pulse you take, any kind of Gaussian pulse, you will find that the ratio between this channel is always more than 2. So the question you ask, can we bring this ratio less than 2. So can we make this channel dominant? So, and this channel less preferred. And we have shown that by doing the calculations. I'm not going to tell the details, but what we have done it basically, nothing but the basically, this coherent control, basically we have looked into the, we have designed the laser pulse using some kind of theory, optimal control theory, which basically what it does the, phases, the phase between the different part of the wave packet in such a way that this channel is preferred, basically D plus OH channel. So it's completely the interference between the different channels which controls the ratio between these two channels, and that we do by the laser pulse. So the question we ask, can we design a laser pulse by using some kind of theory which dictates the interference between the different component of the wave packet which is moving on the first excited state of the HOD molecule, which interferes in such a way that instead of giving this channel as a preferred product, give the this channel. And this is completely controlled by the interference between the two channels. There's another example, this one. And the second work was done by basically the group of Deepak Mathur. And what they did the experiment. And this is again the water molecule. This is also a water molecule. The hydrogen is replaced by the deuterium. This is the exactly water molecule. There is no replacement. So they took the water molecule and put the very strong layer field. And what they found these two channels, and that's expected. But they also found this H2 plus, and that was unexpected, because if you look on the electron crowd between these two channels, it's quite far away. So, and one thing's counter, it's a counterintuitive, because normally when you put the laser pulse, it's basically bonds are broken, but here it's a kind of bond formation. So they gave a very fancy title of their paper, saying the bond formation in the ultrasound, very strong laser pulse. So this also one, in order to explain this, one has to look it in terms of the coherent control of the in terms of the coherent control and the interference between the different part of the wave packets. Here also, so this is very important, especially in terms of the how the energy flow. If you want to control the energy flow inside a molecular system, basically one can look in terms of the focusing and defocusing of the wave packet. And this is taken from the famous Ahmadwell JPC paper. So what we have showed that basically by using the interference between the different components of the wave packet, one can basically control the focusing and defocusing. One can spread and contract the wave packet. So this phenomenon also we can explain in terms of the wave packet, and basically it's nothing but the interference phenomena. There another example which is given by, again the experiment was done by the group of Deepak Mathur, and what they showed basically that if you take a molecule and put a very strong layer field, and that molecule was unstable, and it become stable in the very strong layer field. And they told that this very fancy title, bond hardening under the influence of intense ultrasalt layer fields. And again, you can explain this in terms of the interference between the different component of the wave packet. In fact, the title of this paper, which we published, we told this the time-dependent bond hardening. So time-dependent wave packet, the wave packet is very, very important in this phenomena. You cannot explain this phenomena in terms of the static time-independent Schrodinger equation. You have to go look into the time-dependent Schrodinger equation. You have to construct the wave packet. You have to look the time evolution of the wave packet, and then only you can explain it and the bond hardening in the molecule. It's exactly the same concept what is explained in this PRL paper which I showed. And the last which I would like to say, look on this system, this molecule. So this is IBR molecule. And what you do, if you excite this molecule from here and do by different kind of laser pulses, it will go here and it will come here, and then here, because of this crossing, part of it can go, the wave packet can go on this state, and part of this can go to this state. And normally it has been found that the ratio between the excited state and the ground state is quite different. So this is dominant one, and this is very, normally it's found in very less amount. So one can ask the question, can we do the control of this channel? So can I make this product in more favorable? And again, one can do this interference between the different part of the wave packet to do the control between the of this chemical reaction. So I'm not going to talk about all this. I will talk about only last one because now that we have already 118. So let me go to my last few slides. And come to maybe this one here. But before I go and so I would like to show this paper by the Paul Bloom and Shapiro. So what they showed basically, if you do this weak field limit control, so in the long time limit, you cannot do basically the control. And there was an analytical proof they gave. And that was true, basically. So if you go in the long time limit, let me go to that particular equation, maybe. If you go into long time limit, the probability will not depend on the time. But later, Nils and Dixon and Coburg, they showed, if there is an adiabatic, a non-adiabatic crossing, then you can do the control up to certain limit, up to some extent. And that's what we did. We look into this. So in this paper, what we did, we took the some kind of laser pulse, and then we start doing the chirping of this laser pulse. And by chirping, what we did, when you chirp a laser pulse, basically you retain the bandwidth of the laser pulse. So the frequency distribution remains the constant, and therefore the energy in the pulse remains the constant. So you are not putting the extra energy in the system, even that you are doing the changing the chemical reactivity of the system. And by taking the different chirp of the pulses, and we took this different chirp, and then we started doing the excitation of this. Let me see if this video is working. Yeah, see, so that's what we did. We excited it here, and you see how it goes here, and then it dissociates and bifurcate on these two channels, and then it starts moving on these two channels. And by doing this, what we found is, although in the long time limit, we cannot do any control, but in the intermediate times, we can do the control for different chirping of the laser pulse. What it means, we retain the bandwidth of the laser pulse same, but we are able to control the chemical reactions in this time domain. And it has although the pulse is over here, even that after the pulse is over, we are able to control the branching ratio between the excited state and the ground state up to some time. And it has importance because if you have a different branching ratio at this time, you can excite the molecule from here to some other state, and then you can do further control. But what one would like to do the coherent control in the long time regime here. And that's what we did in the next work. So these are details, that's not important. So I'm not good. So what we did in the next work, we took the two laser pulses, and what started doing basically start increasing the time delay between these two laser pulses. And by time delaying these two laser pulses, what we can do basically, we are basically exciting the ground state to the excited state at different times. And therefore, we are controlling the interference between the different component of the wave packet. And therefore, inside the momentum in the wave packet and so on. And therefore, you are able to control the bifurcation in the wave packet. So this is all about how you control the interference. And what we showed that by doing this, we are able to control the branching ratio. So this is what I plotted, relative yield of the excited state as a function of the time delay between the two pulses. And what we found that we can do basically 10% control for different kind of pulses. The phases we have taken 0, pi by 2, and pi. And we can do the 10% control. But 10% control is not a very big thing. One would like to do 100% control. So what we did, we we thought, can we do further manipulation with the interferences? And that's what we did in the next paper. So these are all details, yeah. So next paper, that's what we do. We introduced, so this molecule has many, many excitation. So we started, what we did, we took this one of the intermediate states. And what we did, the center frequency of the pulse we choose in such a way that the total frequency is here. But what we did, we divided this into the two frequencies. So first one is the two pulses. One excite from here to here, then we excite from here to this state. And therefore, we are creating more avenues for the interference and constructive as well as the destructive interference. And if you do this, what we have shown that basically, although we keep the total energy in the system same, but by simply changing the center frequency a little bit by 200 centimeter inverse, what we showed, and some of the center frequency we kept constant. So total energy in the laser pulse which we are giving to the system remain constant. So it's actually controlled by the interference of the control of chemical reaction by only interference into the different part of the wave packet. And what we showed that basically, let me go to the one slide where I've shown that. This one, you see, we can almost do the control about 80%. So we can see the power of the interference. What we say the coherent control. So the power of coherent control is that we can completely switch off one channel and completely switch on other channel. That's what we need in the quantum information, switch on and switch off the channels. Switch on and switch off the channels in some sense. And by doing this in this particular example, we're able to do the almost 100% control. And then we went and tried to understand how we did it. So these are all details analysis part. So that's not important. The point which I wanted to focus that whatever the concept we use in chemistry in coherent control of chemical reaction, you can exactly translate this concept in the quantum information theory. And therefore, chemistry has a lot of avenue to work in the area of quantum information. So with this, let me acknowledge my students. So all of them have basically contributed in some sense. And basically the Manish Garg, he started this project in some sense. He was my first master student and he did extremely well. Then Arvindo did also very well. All of them have some scientist position in the Germany. Both of them have the scientist position in Germany. Smita, although did not contribute in this project, but she worked on the molecule surface scattering. And she recently got a position in the Johnson Matthews. So she got a very good offer. So just after completing PhD, she completed PhD 6 months ago. And this company was happy to hire her or some kind of simulation work. So I wanted to just mention it here because the quantum chemistry, for doing the quantum chemistry, also you have a lot of avenue to get the jobs in the industry. And she got a very high package, very, very high package, almost similar to assistant professor, associate professor job in ISL Kolkata. And Diptesh is doing postdoc at UCL. He also contributed to the laser molecule interactions. Senior works on the molecule surface scattering. So he did a lot of work. He is currently doing postdoc in the Netherlands. And that's finally, I would like to acknowledge SCRV for the funding. Thank you for your attention. And I will be happy to answer some questions. Hello?
Thank you, Professor Ashwini Tiwari. This was a very nice talk. So from the students, if you have questions, you can type them in the Zoom box, or at least let me know you have a question and I will ask you to unmute. I'm also looking at the YouTube channel, so if someone wants to write a question from the YouTube session, that's also fine. Okay, so we have a question. Okay. Thank you, sir, for such a lovely presentation. This is from Rinal Thapa. My question here is, what are the limitations of this coherent control of these systems? And if we are to generate qubits using this method?
So to be honest, I don't have much expertise on the other parts, like the quantum information. But what I understand in the chemistry, when you do the chemistry, when you do the one photon excitation, in the one photon excitation, the long time limit, it's difficult to do the coherent control. But in qubits, I don't have understanding how, what is the limitations. Yeah.
Okay, we have another one from Aniket Kashyap. In quantum mechanics, time is a classical background parameter and the flow of time is universal and absolute. In general relativity, time is one component of four-dimensional space-time and the flow of time changes depending on the curvature of space-time and the space-time trajectory of the observer. How can these two concepts of time be reconciled?
Oh, okay. It's maybe Professor Panigrahi can answer. So I don't have expertise in answering. Maybe Sangeeta, you do have can you answer this question?
Why are you putting me into trouble?
So Aniket, I don't have background in the relativity theory. So it's difficult to answer your question. But maybe I can go back and look into it and I can answer it too. Maybe anybody else, if somebody else wants to answer this question.
Yes. So I can only tell you something, that there is something called relativistic quantum mechanics. So that there, of course, you do, I would assume that the time plays the same role in relativistic quantum mechanics as in classical relativity. But how that is exactly manifest, I cannot tell you. But in case you're not aware, there is relativity plus quantum mechanics, there are theories which deal with this.
Yeah, can I add a little bit here?
Yeah. Can I make a comment here?
Yeah, yeah.
Okay. So my comment is, the relativistic quantum mechanics is based on Dirac equation. Now that is basically, in an exact sense, that is one particle formulation. So that relativity, for a many particle system is an approximation. So exact mapping from, relativistic quantum mechanics and many electron system and many nuclear system will be, very, very approximate. So from there to make some real conclusion is difficult.
So we have a follow-up question from Rinal Thapa. Actually, there is a phenomena named as ultra-fast charge migration, which is also based on this coherent control, where there is similar kind of oscillation between states that is controlled by chirp laser. Can we use this method to generate qubits?
So what I would like to comment about this, basically, whenever you have this interference phenomena, you can use it. Whatever the wave packet is coming from the charge migration, so the charge migration or any other things, if it's a wave packet and you are able to create this interference, you will able to use it. You should be able to use it. Yeah, that's my answer.
Aswini, I have a question. Yes, Sangeeta, can I ask you a question?
Yes, please, go ahead.
Yeah. See, Aswini, aren't there some theorems in chemistry, regarding this creation of coherence and things like that? Because I vaguely know, I'm not very sure.
Yes, Pohl-Brummer theorem, I did not talk in details, but there are theorems, like the Pohl-Brummer and the Shapiro theorems. What they say, in the long, if it's adiabatic states, long time, in the long time, asymptotic times, you cannot do the weak field controls. That's what they say.
Okay.
So I had one more short question. So maybe you have mentioned it. So is there some direction dependence or orientation dependence of this control?
Of course, you can play around with the wave packet control. Of course, the wave packet interference, all these things will depend on the many parameters. The parameters you can control.
Okay.
Yeah.
May I comment here? May I comment here?
Yeah, please.
So you see, Oshini was really correct. I just elaborate. So all the quadrant control and what you say, that is basically Herschel Ravi's, right, Oshini? So yeah. All these things are basically strong field regime, John Munch and all this. Now basically this control, it is, you can do, as for example, let's say you take a molecule, water molecule, and now you want to dissociate one of the bond rather than other. Then you can orient your laser with the calculating the vector, permanent vector of that molecule. And accordingly, let's say ozone you take, and you take one of the oxygen 16, another oxygen is 18. Now you can orient your laser considering, laser is a vector field. Now considering the, dipole moment, permanent dipole moment of that molecule, you can orient your laser field according to the bond you want to dissociate. So that's the way it is possible. Yes, I guess.
Okay, thank you. Yeah, I was wondering the same, that it should be possible to choose where you shine the laser. Okay, so I think we've had a nice discussion. So so this is the last talk of the session, I guess. So we can stop for lunch now.
Yeah.
Good job, Ashwini. Very nice.
Yeah.
Thank you all for a very exciting session.
But Sangeeta, where is our lunch? You people are going for lunch.
I think Kushal Panigrahi has to send money to all of
us.
money cannot be converted into food.
Panigrahi said,
that's the good part of this WhatsApp, that you sit at home and enjoy good talks.
Panigrahi said, you have to throw few rockets from Hyderabad, Kolkata to Chennai, one rocket to send lunch to Professor Satyamurthy. Another rocket to Jadavpur.